I was walking down the hallway to see the infamous dude standing there, doing his old trick to pick on some shy student. Get that filthy hand off him now! Then I grabbed him and threw him away like a piece of paper. Ah, that's better. Konnichiwa, I'm Yukiko from Japan, the daughter of Fuji, a famous martial art master and the principal of a karate school. As his only child, it's up to me to evolve my warrior spirit and protect the weak from any baka. And this shy girl is Chiharu, the one I saved from a fight with the rival school gang. And ever since then, we became besties. Well, that's also how I earned the nickname Big Boss. I don't really care about it, but it does have some perks. I always had the best reserved seat next to the window, a desk drawer full of snacks, and on top of that, the kid was competing every day to do my homework. However, it also caused me some complications. I seem to have caught the eye of Jun, that rival school's gang leader. He bought me flowers and sent me these cheesy cupcakes every day, but I only gave him a no. Hey, he comes again.
If I was your boyfriend, never let you go. Keep you on my arm, girl. Yukiko, never be alone.
Tomato, tomato! Throwing tomatoes! Even when the guard came carrying him away, he was still shouting.
Yukiko, die, scooter!
Gosh, he's such a bug. Later, I came into the classroom and found everyone was going cuckoo over something. How noisy!
That's the new student. He's just so handsome.
As if you could tell someone's handsome from the back. But when he turned around, my eyes almost bulged from their sockets. It's Akira. Back when we were little, I adored Akira from the moment I first saw him. To me, he was even cuter than my favorite Mochi Shiba plushie. So I followed him everywhere and gave him all the candies I had. But he didn't like it that much.
Why did you give her my candies? I like Akira. If you take him from me, I'll punch you. Hey, martial arts is not about fighting nonsense. You fierce kid. I hate you.
After a while, Akira's family moved away and I'd completely lost contact with him. And now he's back. Our eyes met, but he looked so cold and turned away. He didn't recognize me? Fine. It was so embarrassing facing him again anyway, so I decided to avoid him like the plague since then. And just like that, with his excellent academic ability, Akira soon fell into place as the top student, while I'm a bit different. I may have been a black belt in the karate, but exams were definitely not my thing.
Congratulations, you've excelled at coming last again. So, Yukiko, I've appointed another student to tutor you.
Please don't say his name. Please don't say his name. Please, please, please.
Akira,
I nearly died on the spot. Can anybody throw me to Mars, please? Man, it's super awkward. I kept looking at the ground when he blurted out,
Hi, Yukiko. Long time no see.
So, he does remember me? During the lesson, I couldn't focus, and my body was heating up. I kept my mouth shut while he was immersed in his lecture.
If there's anything you don't understand, feel free to ask.
I plucked up my courage and said, Why didn't you like me when we were kids?
You're still acting like before. I'm trying to teach you, but your head's stuck in the clouds. Focus.
He didn't say he hated me, did he? My heart fluttered again. Guess I'd have to try harder to get his attention then. But things didn't exactly go as planned. During the lessons with Akira, my phone rang constantly with calls and messages. Seemed like my goons were in trouble and they needed my help. I tried my best to ignore it, but finally gave in. I've got something to do. I'll be right back. Hey, those morons. They're always messing around, then leave it to me. Problem solved. Only that,
lucky for you, I got there in time.
In time to cause more trouble? I'd have eaten them for breakfast without you. Back at school, I saw Akira standing at the gate with a clearly not happy face. Akira, it's not like what you think.
You find it hard to study, but fighting seems to come naturally to you, huh? Who the freak are you? How dare you talk to my girl like that?
Akira, I fight to help people. It's not nonsense.
Help? I suppose brainless people only know how to talk with their fists.
Jun immediately lunged at Akira, raising his fists at him. I had to hold him back right away and told him to go. The silence went on for some minutes, but when he was about to leave, I couldn't stand it anymore. Just because I liked you then, you think you have the right to look down on me?
What?
Hear this. I do like you, but it doesn't mean I will like you forever.
I don't care, but I'm sorry if the truth I spoke made you feel that I looked down on you. And you know what? If you can't take my tutoring seriously, then we're done.
Fine, go! See if I care. I, the big boss myself, have my own limits and cannot be chasing him all the time. But I couldn't deny that a pit was dropping to the bottom of my stomach. I just want to go home and curl up undercover. Then I arrived at my family's karate academy to see it was all sealed off, and my dad was sitting on the doorstep holding a letter. Dad? What happened?
Yukiko, I'm bankrupt. I had no choice but to sell the academy to moneylenders. I've lost everything.
No! This academy is our family legacy. My dad's life's work. We couldn't lose it.
So I followed the address on the letter, but there I met an unexpected person. June! Turns out, his dad is my dad's creditor. All or nothing, I decided to get straight to the point to him. What do my family have to do to get our martial arts school back?
June came over and whispered something in his ear. Then he pondered a while and said, My son kept goofing around. Change him and the martial arts school is back to yours.
But how?
I want you to get engaged to my son.
Are you serious? You think I'm a joke?
Then I immediately stood up and left. That was insane.
Hey, why are you behaving like that?
You're still asking why?
It's down to that dude, isn't it? He's just some preppy know-it-all who doesn't even like you.
You know nothing. He also likes me, I think.
Is that so? Then prove it. Make Akira fall in love with you within 2 weeks, and I'll convince my father to extend the deadline by 3 months. Fail, and we get engaged. I'm the one who is always by your side.
No way I agree with your stupid deal.
Go ahead, refuse. The martial arts school will be permanently closed tomorrow.
Wait, okay, I'm in. Lucky enough, I had Chiharu, the love guru, to help me cook up the perfect Get Akira scheme. Though she'd been single, like, forever. Firstly, I told my gang that Akira'd soon to be my BF, and also their boss, so he deserved a special treat. Wherever he went, other students bowed 90 degrees to greet him. They tended to his every need, carried his bag, and were always at his service. But he seemed not so comfortable about this.
Ask your goons to stop their nonsense.
Okay, as long as you agree to my conditions.
What?
Tutor me again. Oh, and have lunch together. And walk to and from school?
I can't.
Okay then, guys!
Fine!
Secondly, you needed to find out what Akira liked,
but he'll refuse to answer my questions for sure.
My fake council survey will answer that.
Then she handed out the paper to the whole class. My goofy Chiharu did get it done this time. Okay, according to a philosopher, the way to a man's heart is through his stomach. Akira's most favorite food is beef, so I rummaged through all the local supermarkets to find A5 Wagyu beef and prepared this perfect meal for him. Akira, eat this.
Oh, thank you, Cream Puff. How come you know I like beef?
How did you get in here?
I know you miss me, so I come to visit.
Before I could say anything, Akira shook his head and walked off. Okay, the first step is always the hardest. Next, seeing that Akira liked horror movies, I lied to him that Chiharu stood me up, so I had an extra ticket. It's insidious. How could he refuse? But as soon as we sat down, a familiar face caught my attention.
June? Stop messing with me, you child!
Eh? I'm a horror fan, just like you. We're sure a match made in heaven.
I tried to ignore him and focus on my plan. This was the third time I watched this, so I knew exactly when there'd be a jump scare. It's time. I pasted a whining look on my face and was about to lean on Akira when June suddenly screamed his lungs out and jumped at me. It was not until he fell asleep that we had a bit of privacy. But from then till we left, Akira didn't speak a word and even asked to leave early. That's not okay. If things kept going this way, the whole plan would definitely fail. And it means I'd have to get engaged to June. No! The next day, I wasn't in the mood for dealing with my friends, so I lingered back in the classroom and read through Akira's notes. Oh, what's this? So, he does care about me. I can see one ray of hope. Akira, I want to improve my studies. Help me?
Oh, okay.
I was waiting outside for Akira to get us some bubble teas before we started when suddenly this thief darted out and snatched this old lady's bag. I dove in there to help, but he knocked me to the ground and ran away.
Here you go.
You're already fighting again? Don't you have anything better to do?
I'm not forget it anyway. This brave young lady helped me.
What?
Say no more. I'm a bad person no matter what. Then I stormed off without looking back. I was so stupid to catch feels with that insensitive one. Then my knee suddenly collapsed. Right then, a hand reached out and gently wrapped a bandage around my knee.
Leave me alone.
Get on my back.
Shut up.
Come on.
I couldn't help but smile through my frown, and my heart did a cartwheel. I clambered onto his back and looped my arms around his neck.
Hey, I'm sorry. I didn't know that you...
It's okay.
Are you dumb? An injured leg is not enough?
It's nothing. And... You don't have to carry me like this. Am I heavy?
What? If I say yes, will you jump off?
No way. After that day, Akira changed towards me. He joined me for lunch and even gave me a cute cupcake, and agreed to go to Cat Cafe with me, even though he's allergic. And the classes went so smoothly. He was sweet like a lollipop and answered to all my silly questions. One time, I even accidentally saw him putting a lot of bandages in my locker. Aww. Winning the bet didn't seem so impossible then, but suddenly a girl approached him. It was Amaya, the school's popular girl. They chewed the fat. Then she leaned closer and whispered something to him. His face suddenly turned cold. Then he walked away. I was about to go after him when my phone beeped.
Can't tutor you today. I have a play audition.
So, turns out Akira and Amaya were both in this play. Fine, if Akira's Romeo, then I must be Juliet. I made it to the final round with my big boss energy, which meant I got to act out a scene with Akira to see who got the female lead between me and Amaya. Oh dear, look at them, being all clingy for what? That snake was all over my poor Akira like a rash. Ugh, if Chiharu hadn't constantly held me back, I'd have jumped there and given her a piece of my mind. And now, it's time for me to shine. But why is Akira's face darkened? It's okay, maybe he's trying to be professional? My bounty is as boundless as the sea. My love, as adoring as a puppy dog's nose. Yes, so I may have forgotten the words, but it wasn't that bad. He may pick me for my quick thinking and...
I choose Amaya, miss.
Hey, why did you pick her?
You shouldn't ask me. Ask yourself instead.
Then he left with Amaya without glancing at me. But today is the end of the 2-week deadline. I thought you'd have some feelings for me too. It was pouring rain. I trudged home. All collapsed, tears and rain falling down all over my face. It was all over. The bed I play, the boy I love. I should have known better that it was me, onto a loser right from the outset. Through my teary eyes, I saw June running towards me.
Yukiko, what's wrong? Tell me.
I lost.
What?
The bet. Between us. I lost it. I was wrong. About everything.
Who cares about the bet? You might get a cold, you know. Get inside.
But why you're here?
I don't care if you think it's too late. I'm telling you anyway. I know that I'm not perfect like him. I do say the wrong thing. I forget all the time, but I can protect and will never hurt you. So will you marry me?
My head was spinning, and in a moment of weakness, I said yes. At least I can save my dad's school and be with the right person who truly cares about me, instead of chasing some jerk who thought so low of me. I confided in Chiharu and my family about this, but kept it a secret from everyone else. My father didn't approve it at first, but seeing my determination, he reluctantly agreed. It was our fitting day. I was with June discussing our wedding, but he seemed distracted and kept checking his phone. Then he said he had to take a call and hurried out. Sensing something was up, I followed him. Huh? Why is he talking to Amaya?
You have to thank me for your new fiancé. I told Akira about your bet.
Excellent job, as promised.
It's not about the money. It's about making Akira mine.
I don't get why both you and my beautiful Yukiko like that dude so much. Anyway, Yukiko's waiting for me. Gotta go.
I couldn't believe what was in front of me. What the heck are you doing here? So it's you who made up everything the whole time?
No, Yukiko, let me explain.
I trusted you, June, but look what you've done. You know what? You win. Do your worst. I don't care anymore.
Then I ran home as fast as I could. Why do boys all fool me around like that? Right when I felt more disheartened than ever, I met the one that I didn't want to see the most. What was Akira doing here?
Yukiko, let's talk.
We have nothing to talk about. Chiharu told me what you're doing. You can't marry June. You liked me, so you mustn't fall for another one that easily.
What? So you're the commander of my feelings now? Aren't you with Amaya?
I'm not, and I never did. Listen, I was so angry to find out I was just part of your bet with June, so I ignored you. But then Chiharu told me why you did it and made me understand.
So what? Anyway, you never liked me. I'm not gentle and too fierce, as you said before. Don't try to pity me.
I don't. It's that I do like you. At first, I thought you were the type of person who'd use violence to solve any problem. But the more I got to know you, the more I learned about your pure heart. I shouldn't have judged you so quickly. I'm sorry.
What just happened? I might be dreaming? But no, Akira, my 7-year crush, just confessed his love with me. So, Akira and I got together. June was furious about it, but he kept his word, and now my dad has 3 months to pay off his debt. I'm helping him out by teaching karate classes to earn money, something I really enjoy. Everything was great, too great, until...
Yukiko, I gotta tell you something. I have to go abroad to study. I'll leave tomorrow.
What? I don't understand. Why so sudden?
I prepared for it months ago, but I couldn't tell you.
I didn't want to make you sad. Will you wait for me?
Of course not. I may get bored and start liking another by that time.
It's time. I stood still watching the train pass by until I noticed Akira's melancholy smile. I liked you 7 years ago, and now I still do. So of course I can wait for you. Come back soon, Akira.
Let me tell you something. Something really important. I have acrophobia, so this is my idea of a nightmare. I don't want to be here at all. Oh, and that guy on the other side is Charlie. He's my boyfriend, but I don't actually like him like that. So you're probably wondering how I ended up here. 200 meters above the ground and about to make this terrifying leap? Well, let's just start from the beginning. Hi, I'm Luna, a 17-year-old high school girl from a small town in New South Wales. Growing up, I was desperate to please my hardworking single mom. The problem was she was nearly always tired and irritable. So no matter what I said or did, it usually ended up being wrong. The most common words that came out of her mouth were, "If you want me to love you, you have to be nice." I wanted her to love me more than anything else in the world, so I did everything I could to appease her. This led to the need to make everyone happy, and left me with an unfathomable fear of being hated by others. If I made other people happy, then they'd like me, right? So whenever someone asked me to do their homework or cover for them on roll call, I did so without hesitation. And if there's ever an argument or awkward situation, regardless of if I'm to blame or not, I always apologize first. At 15, I moved to Sydney alone for high school, and that's when I met my roommate Margot. She's my complete opposite, but this didn't stop us from becoming best friends. She's independent, sassy, and doesn't let anyone pressure her into doing anything she doesn't want to. Guys, if I were more like her, I would have been able to avoid a lot of trouble. Once we had a group assignment in biology, and I, by chance, teamed up with these two popular girls, the day before the deadline, they both texted me, saying they were sick, and asked me to do their parts. This was a lot of work for one person, but I didn't want to upset them, so I agreed. But then, that night, while I was scrolling through Instagram during my brief break after hours of studying, I saw them checking in at a party. What? So they lied to me so they could go out and have fun and left me home alone to do their homework? Oh my, I just want to take this pen and throw it right at their dumb duck faces. How is that cute in anyway? Ugh, but who was I kidding? I knew full well I'd never be able to tell them what I really thought of them. So I picked up the pen and continued my workload meant for three people alone. I stayed up all night and drank 3 cans of energy drinks, but it was just too much work for one person to finish on time. Our assignment, or should I say my assignment, got points deducted due to late submission, which somehow made the popular girls mad. What have you done? How could you turn in the assignment late? I'm sorry. It's just that doing it all by myself was a bit too much for me. Oh, please. You had the whole day to finish it. It's all down to your poor time management. Right at that moment, Margot appeared out of nowhere and stepped between us. Pfft, if you both cared so much about your grades, then you would have helped Luna complete it. Instead of going to some stupid party, how about I report you to the teacher to cross out your names from Margot? Enough. Sorry, don't mind her. Then I quickly pulled Margot away. Apologizing to them was a ridiculous thing to do. It wasn't your fault. I know it's not my fault, but there's no point making a scene out of it, right? Fine. In that case, I'll leave you alone with all the troubles you've caused yourself. I don't care anymore. Oh, no, I didn't mean to make Margot mad. I quickly apologized to her, told her she was my best friend in the whole world, and asked her to go for a milkshake to make up. A week later, on the day my volunteer club was selling lemonade to raise funds for a children's charity, I suddenly fell sick. Oh no, I'd been telling everyone at the club how important this event was, but now I was the one who'd be absent. How embarrassing! I needed to show them how sincere I was. I texted the club president that I was sick, but if the club really needed me, I could still try to participate. Ah, now I can finally sleep. But who would know? Before I even had time to curl up in bed, he texted back saying how they really needed my help. So if I could come, that'd be great. Oh, no. Did I really have to drag my feverish self over there? Not knowing what to do, I turned to Margot for advice, but she snapped at me. If you knew you couldn't go, why suggest otherwise? People will always take advantage of you if you let them. So just make it clear that you're sick and can't participate. Then she told me how her music club had a dinner meeting tonight, yet she'd already decided she was having a relaxing pamper session tonight, so she immediately told them she was otherwise engaged. Ugh, Margot was right. If I'd done as she said in the first place, I wouldn't have had to rack my brains looking for excuses to say no without annoying anyone. Finally, I texted the club president that I was afraid of infecting everyone, so I'd better stay home. Then I fell asleep and found my worries plaguing my dreams. The next day, I felt better. So after class, I dropped by the club's room, but I instantly felt weird vibes from everyone. Then when I asked the club president how much money we'd earned from the event, he totally blanked me. Oh, no. He was obviously still mad with me for letting him down. I was lost in thoughts when suddenly someone tapped me on the shoulder.
I heard you were sick. Are you feeling better now?
It was Charlie, one of the club members. He told me that day I was off sick. He voluntarily took over all of my work. So I invited him out for a thank you dinner right away. Maybe he misunderstood my goodwill gesture, as after that he bombarded me with texts, calls, and soppy memes. Then one day while we were walking together, Charlie suddenly stopped and took my hand.
Luna, we've known each other for a while now.
I think it's time for me to confess my feelings.
I like you. Will you go out with me?
Oh my. What did he just say? I stood there dumbfounded. I mean, I liked him as a friend, but not romantically. But when I met his expectant gaze, my conscience began to torment me. He was such a nice guy, so how could I say no to him? In the end, I forced a smile and nodded in agreement. My feelings for him will develop over time, right? But unfortunately, the answer to this was no. Actually, since we started dating, I found myself liking him even less than before. He does a lot of things that irritate me, such as the time he insisted we wear couple outfits to school. Yeah, slogan shirts with "he's mine, she's mine" printed on them should definitely be left in 2010. Ugh. He smugly ushered me around the school and seemed oblivious to the laughs and points in our direction. If only the ground could just open up and swallow me right away. That evening, noticing how fed up I looked, Margot asked me if everything was going all right between me and Charlie. So I told her everything. I thought she'd get mad at me again, but to my surprise, she just sighed and told me to tell the truth and break up with Charlie before things got too serious. That's the best way to stop both of us from getting hurt. And also, I've heard a lot of bad things about Charlie. People say he's kinda erratic. You better get this over with as soon as possible. Yeah, Margot's right. Next time I saw Charlie, I was ending this once and for all. Turns out I didn't have to wait long, because that Sunday afternoon, Charlie came to pick me up for our date. He told me he had a surprise in store for me, and I was gonna love it. Okay, it sounds like he'd gone to loads of effort, so it was probably best if I left breaking up with him until the journey home.
Almost there!
Hearing what Charlie said, I looked out the window and... Oh my god! Is that a bungee jumping spot? So, long story short, here I am, 200 meters off the ground, my legs trembling like a leaf and my heart thudding like crazy. I was about to cry out of fear when suddenly I heard romantic music playing behind me. I turned around to see Charlie getting down on one knee. Behind him was eagle-eyed staff holding roses and candles while swaying to the music. What's happening?
I know we haven't been dating long, but it's clear that we're made for each other. Luna, will you marry me?
What? Did I hear him wrong? I mean, I'm only 17. Seeing my puzzled look, Charlie hurriedly said,
I know we're still in high school, but don't worry, we can wait till graduation. Then let's have the most wonderful wedding straight after that.
This was insane. I stood there, rooted to the floor, not knowing what to do, and seeing everyone watching and waiting made me feel even more pressured. I was trying to figure all this out when Charlie forced the ring on my finger. Oh my god. What should I do? What should I do? Well, in classic me fashion, I didn't do anything. My stupid hand just froze in place. And in the end, it turned out like this. No, I couldn't let this happen. Charlie, actually, I don't have feelings for you. I was going to tell you today, but I didn't expect things to end up like this.
You're kidding me, right? If you didn't like me, you wouldn't have let me put the ring on earlier.
So I explained everything to Charlie. His face darkened with disappointment. I felt so guilty. I should have just been straight with him from the beginning, then none of this would have happened. We can still be friends, can't we? I asked, but Charlie replied without even looking at me.
If you don't like me, then why give me hope?
Why the emotionless tone? It felt like he'd turned into a completely different person. Afraid, I kept quiet, not daring to blurt out so much as a word. I'd be home soon and away from this suffocating atmosphere. But as Charlie drove, I noticed how the surroundings became stranger and stranger. This is definitely not the way to the dormitory. Finally, the car stopped at an abandoned construction site.
Luna, get out of the car.
Sensing his irritable tone, I did as he said.
You can stay here until you've figured out that we're destined for each other. Then call me.
I watched in horror as he drove away and left me there. I was all alone, in the middle of nowhere. Panicked, I called Margot for help, but as soon as she picked up, my phone ran out of power. I explored the area, but it was completely deserted. Would I be stuck here forever without anyone knowing? It was getting late. I'd barely eaten or drank anything all day, and this felt hopeless. I burst into tears, and then everything fell dark around me. I woke up to the bright lights of the hospital. Margot jumped in to give me a hug, then explained what had happened. Turns out that night after I called her, she checked my location on Snapchat and saw that I was in some deserted place. Sensing something was off, Margot and the dormitory manager went to find me and took me to the hospital. Charlie was disciplined and detained for a month for the trouble he'd caused. After that horrible experience, I talked a lot with Margot. She comforted me, encouraged me, and said that it seemed like my desire to please others stemmed from childhood trauma. Perhaps it was my mother's words. If you want me to love you, you have to be nice. That created the character I have now. I couldn't continue to let the past consume me. That summer, when I returned home to see my mom, together, we poured out our feelings and faced our problems. I finally figured out that being nice to people wasn't a bad thing, but agreeing to things just to avoid disappointing people isn't the correct thing to do at all. Now, with Margot's help, I'm step by step learning to say no to things I don't want to do. 'Cause life's way too short to say yes to everything. Don't you think?
I was skipping to the kitchen to see the apple bag Dad had prepared for my school picnic.
Aw, how thoughtful of him.
I excitedly took a bite, but it tasted like it had been left to rot for a decade. I frantically checked the bag and saw this was not the only bad one.
Dad!
Hey, I'm Doris, and things like this are an everyday occurrence for me. My dad's clumsy and colorblind, two contributing factors that sure make life interesting. Since Mom passed away, I had to watch him like a hawk, else you betcha he'd mess stuff up. One time he roasted a turkey, but it was so raw as if it would jump off the plate and run around the house. And on my last birthday, he got me a pair of mittens, with one bright orange and one neon green. I reluctantly tried them on, looking like a clown while people burst out laughing. Despite all that, he's still an awesome dad in my eyes. A super talented artist with incredible artwork, provided he lets me label the paint colors. And also a really big supporter of my dream. From the first time he helped me skate on the lake, I knew it was my life's calling.
If I can be an artist, even though I'm colorblind, how can just a few bumps stop you from being a figure skater?
Bravo. I'll definitely give him a 100, except that he does have one bonkers rule. No dating until I'm 18. Whatever, it's not like I gave boys much thought. The only boy I spoke to was my neighbor, Ben, and Dad seemed to like him.
That kid's pretty good. He likes drawing and artists are caring people, just like me. And he seems to not attracted to girls, either.
I'm not sure about that, but it's true that we can never be a couple. His mushy manner is definitely not my type. Anyway, it's super fun having him as a friend. Since we were little, Ben always went along with anything I asked, from drawing me a unicorn picture from my room, giving me his only ice pop, to more exciting things, such as knocks and runs, and covering the neighbor's car in toilet paper. And now, he always escorts me to my skating practice a few towns away, and just sits there scribbling something until I finish. This whole month I've been practicing so hard for the upcoming big competition in town. I'm gonna bring a medal home! This is my time to shine! I started gliding, letting the rhythm control my movement. The cold, calming breeze pushed against me like I was flying. It's time for an axel jump. I sprang into the air like a cotton ball, but suddenly lost my balance and fell flat on my face. As a result, I was ranked 29 out of 30. Duh. But surprisingly, there was one judge giving me all high marks. Finally, someone saw my potential. I was beaming when this cute guy approached me.
Hi, I'm Luke. Just wanted to say that you were absolutely on point out there.
Oh, he's that guy.
I really want to get to know you more. How about we hang out together? I'll take you somewhere as special as you are to me.
This is definitely against Dad's rule, but oh boy, his killer smile made my stomach swoosh. So I ended up saying yes. I excitedly told Ben, but he gave me this sour-faced look.
Hey, your dad will not be happy if he knows this.
Just don't let him know. Luke is an expert, so he can help me hone in on my talent. You will keep this a secret, won't you? So here's my first date ever. Luke was so sweet. He complimented my ice skating and constantly gave me these loving looks. Our food arrived and delish!
Bon appetit.
I daintily tried the mashed potato and immediately felt the delicious taste of warm butter and chives and something pointy? A hairpin? I quickly stood up, demanding to see the manager, but Luke stopped me.
Babe, you found the gift I prepared for you.
Then he grabbed the hairpin and wiped it on his shirt and put it on my hair. Maybe this was a normal thing for guys to do on dates, right? Only his gifts show didn't stop there. Later I found a ring in my steak, then a keychain in my salad.
You're cute, just like this Lotso.
Isn't he the bad guy? But the cherries on top were the movie tickets in my sandwich. Luke, what's this about?
I just hope we could bond over watching movies together. You hate it that much?
No, I didn't mean that. Think about it. It was kinda weird, but also the sweetest thing that had ever happened to me. Luke had a funny way of showing it, but he made me feel special and giddy, and maybe in love? Before I could think straight, he was leaning closer to me. I closed my eyes and was ready for the most romantic kiss ever. But why were his lips so hard and unmoving? What? The menu? And holding it was... Dad?
You know this crazy old man?
I am her father.
Then Dad dragged an extra chair over to our table, plopped down, and started babbling on. Then, when Luke wasn't looking, Dad poured pepper into his coffee. Before I could say anything, poor Luke took a sip and spat it out everywhere.
Sorry. I thought it was sugar. You see, I'm colorblind, so it was an honest mistake.
After that, he accidentally splashed the sauce on Luke's shirt, then grabbed his glass of red wine and poured it over Luke, saying he was trying to clean it.
Enough! Your old man is insane! No one will ever date you again!
Then he stormed away. I was furious! How could Dad embarrass me like this? You're controlling, crazy, and do the stupidest things! You don't allow me to be me, and you just scared away my date! None of his apologies could move me. I had the right to make my own choices without Dad interrupting and being ridiculous. So I used my savings and moved out of my home to start my new life. This freedom was greater than great. I could talk to any guy and go on as many dates as I wanted. Only, I know theirs always were extra eyes on me.
Do you get the feeling someone's watching us?
No way. It's just you and me.
I've had a great time. Do you want to do it again?
Ugh! What the fudge?
If Dad thinks he can stop me by messing around like this, he's totally wrong. It did quite the opposite instead. I started dating loads of guys, even if I didn't like them that much. It was so nice being spoiled by boys, and my room was always full of their presence. I updated Ben all about my dating stories, but he just frowned.
Yo, slow down. You want to speed date the entire town?
Man, it's just dating. It's not like I've agreed to be their girlfriend or anything.
But you don't even know them, or what their intentions are.
My dad doesn't understand me. Why now you sound just like him? Fine, don't feel like you need to come here or give me rides or anything. I can make my own way to school and get my date to come with me to practice from tomorrow.
I'm sorry, Doris. Ignore me. I'm probably just overthinking stuff.
Yeah, Ben's Ben. He's still the one I could count on after all. Anyway, being a serial dater can cause troubles. I muddled up Gregory's interests with Ivan's, and I forgot I already told Anton my hilarious story the third time already. I was late for my date with Hector because my previous shift with Ryan went on longer than I expected. Then being so exhausted from all of this dating, I fell asleep during my meal with Christian. Luckily for me, Ben was always there to help.
What's up? You look exhausted.
I don't know. Dating was fun at first, but now it left me no time to rest, and now I can't even distinguish those guys. Hey, what's so funny?
Nothing. It's just nice not having to share you with an alphabet of guys.
Don't worry. You're the only B in my life. One day after school, a group of boys surrounded me and started accusing me of being a cheater. Hey, it wasn't like I was anyone's girlfriend, so it wasn't classed as cheating. I'm still single, so I can go on many dates as I can. Only, my outburst seemed to make them even angrier, as all these guys shouted at me. A cop walked over. Hang on, is that Dad?
Hey, you boys stop bothering this young lady right now. I just finished a karate course already. I'll give you a piece of my mind. See? Hi-ya! Hi-ya!
What a bunch of weirdos.
Thank God Dad came here on time to save me. But it's such a shame that he saw I was a helpless failure at everything. so my shame became rage. Who asked you to show up in magazine? Quit bugging me with all your nonsense. I can handle this myself. When I returned to my apartment, Ben was sitting there waiting for me. Overwhelmed with everything, I burst into tears. He pulled me into an embrace, and I instantly felt better. But then...
Doris, stop with the games and just go home.
Games? This isn't a game! This is my life! I deserve to live it how I want to! You're too much of a coward to ever understand that! As soon as I said it, I regretted it. Ben looked so hurt and mad. He just shook his head and left. I honestly thought he was the one person who would never leave. But whatever. I didn't need him, or Dad, either. Now I had to prove to Dad that I was mature enough to handle independence and could find someone much better than Ben beside me. Just wait and see. Told you! Now God bless me with this guy, Mark. A super strong and macho BF who was always ready to protect me.
Babe, look out!
What?
Just let me handle this.
Then he moved me out of the way and punched right to the wall. Wow, that's a mosquito. Thank you for saving me. One time, we were strolling through the school's garden when I spotted Ben. I immediately gave Mark a cute damsel in distress look and said, Babe, I'm so tired. I think I'm gonna pass out.
Don't worry, I'll take you to the hospital.
Suddenly, he lifted me over his shoulders and carried me off. My head was spinning, and it made me want to faint. Literally. I begged him to put me down and let me sit for a while. Then, I suddenly saw Ben frowning at me. Huh, seeing me totally fine without him, how can he not be annoyed? But who was that? She started staring at his art passionately. Then, can you believe it? She asked him to draw her, and he agreed! I can't stay here watching this ridiculous play. So I grabbed Mark's hand and pulled him away. But that night, I kept tossing and turning, and the image of Ben and that girl couldn't get out of my head. No big deal. They were just super irritating, that's all. Too many things happened, and now it's time for me to focus on my figure skating dreams again, with my sugar plum. As he went off to buy us some drinks, who should come over to me but my first date disaster, Luke?
Oh, you're still ice skating. Just give up already. I only gave you a high score so you'd date me. Don't flatter yourself. By the way, your crazy old man's still doing good?
Shut up. My dad was right about you, you jerk.
Jerk? Okay, this jerk will tell the rink manager to ban you from coming here for good.
I stared at him, open mouth, not knowing what to say, when out of nowhere, Ben appeared.
I don't think the skating committee would be impressed by your fake scores, do you? All it would take is one email and you can kiss your position on the judging panel goodbye.
How dare you!
Then he left in anger. Right at that moment, Mark returned.
Babe, skating sucks. Just quit it. Let's go for some trampoline then.
Darce, go practice. No one dares to ban you now.
Who the freak are you?
Mark, stop! That's Ben, my friend. No, just an acquaintance.
Darce, watch yourself with that guy.
It's none of your business. Let's go, Mark.
Bye, loser.
The next day at school, I saw Ben with that girl again. My heart thumped in sadness, and I don't even know why. Maybe I was so used to having Ben around me, and honestly, I missed him a lot. Mark soon followed my gaze over to Ben.
Isn't that the dude from the ice rink? Why are you gawping at him?
He was lunging toward Ben right after. I grabbed his arm trying to stop him, but he pulled me away instead to a corner.
You are my girl. Remember that.
In front of me was a total stranger. Not the normal Mark I know. He was supposed to protect me, but now all I felt was scared. I couldn't move. Mark leaned over to kiss me, and I immediately blocked him.
What? How dare you?
Oh no, I'm screwed!
Terrorizing your own girlfriend, I see. Nice.
Ben?
Right on time. You're so done with me.
Then Mark grabbed a flower pot and charged at Ben, but I panickedly pushed him over before he could do anything with it. He stumbled about, mumbling something, when Ben's fist came out of nowhere.
You want another punch?
Mark waved his fist at him, but then turned around and hurried off. I stared at Ben. I couldn't believe my eyes. He was strong and protective, totally different from the soft Ben I knew all this time.
Doris, I think it's time for you to go home. Have you ever wondered why your dad really did that?
Ben was right, and the day's drama made me realize how much I missed Dad. I wonder how he was doing. I arrived back to find Dad sitting all alone, dozing off, amid a pile of mess. He was in stained clothes, and on the easel was an unfinished picture of me. With tear-stained eyes, I ran to him and held him tight. I'm so sorry for leaving. I thought I would be okay by myself, but I'm definitely not. I miss you.
You're back. I miss you too, darling.
I felt so bad for upsetting Dad. When I calmed down, we talked through our problems.
Sweetie, I know. It's just hard. You're all I have left. I just worry you're too young to make the right decision and can't bear seeing these idiots hurt you.
But Dad, I need experience to learn and grow too. Support me, will you?
Of course. I always wish you can find a kind man who understands, supports you, and is always by your side, and makes you truly happy.
All those qualities reminded me of someone. I kept chasing after trivial things out there, thus forgetting the one who was standing by me all the time. So I immediately went to find him. Hey, Ben.
Oh, hey.
You'll be pleased to know I've moved back in with Dad.
Yeah, that is good news.
Look, Ben, I'm sorry. I've been an idiot. I took you for granted, and now I feel very bad for this. I, was wondering if you'll take me to practice tomorrow?
I'll think about it.
And I didn't expect to see you confronting a tough guy like Mark. You're not just a timid, arty type, are you?
Who says I'm timid? I'm only like that when I'm with you, because it makes you happy. I'm actually fully capable of looking after myself. And, you.
Blue sky, white clouds, golden sand. Such a perfect day for sunbathing on this luxury Hawaiian beach, while being served by Kirby, my archenemy. That brat used to tease me all the time about my old clothes and messy hair. Little did she know, I was secretly a millionaire. Earth to chlorine. Castle building all day won't fill your stomach. Finish your shift and go home. Well, Mary, who doesn't want to get rich? Sadly, some of us can only dream about it. If you want to be Cinderella, then go find yourself a prince. Just not Danny. He's just as poor as us. Do not underestimate my Danny. My precious heart fell for him for a reason. It's just that he doesn't seem to realize that we're destined for each other yet. But Mary was right. My dinner won't cook itself. Let's see what we can afford for tonight. My dad left us when I was 4, and since then, Mom worked her socks off to provide for us. So it was down to me to also work to save up for my law school dream. All of a sudden, groceries started raining down on me. Bottles tumbled off the shelves and broke into pieces right by my feet. Ah, is it an earthquake? I stooped down and prayed until it stopped. Thankfully, no one was hurt, but geez, it sure left a freaking mess. Warren, the store owner, looked distraught. This place was all he had, so I helped him clean up and place anything undamaged back on the shelves. Before you leave, please take this as a token of my gratitude. I hope it brings you luck. A lottery ticket? I don't know how this game works. I'll show you. It's simple. Each ticket has a unique set of numbers. Just check the results on TV tonight and see if they match. Let me see. Your numbers are 15, 26, 14, 48, 07, 23. Hey, those are the lucky numbers that have been on my mind all day. I want that ticket. Kirby, stop poking your nose in my business, will you? Sorry, miss. That's the last ticket today, and I already gave it to Chlorine. Then I'll buy it. Here's your $2. Give it to me. You wish. I didn't really care about this ticket, but there's no way I was going to let her get what she wanted. And surely, she wouldn't leave me alone. How about $10? That's a fortune to the likes of you. No thanks. I'd rather win millions instead and make you my maid. Look, you'll never get anything from me, be it this ticket or Danny. Just give up. Fine! Let me skip this stupid ticket, but Danny, never! Why are we always bickering, you ask? Well, we're both competing for the heart of Danny. Tennis extraordinaire and brooding Adonis. Actually, I thought I had more advantage as he worked part-time at the same restaurant. But nope, Danny was such a cold fish. I tried again and again, but every single time, he just gave me a soulless thank you and that's it. If only I could build him his own tennis courts, perhaps he'd change his attitude. But that's impossible for a poor girl like me, unless I somehow hit the jackpot. The lucky numbers today are 48, 07, 15. Should I add winning the lottery to my daydream list? 26, 14. Is it just me or do those numbers sound familiar? No way. It can't be. And the mega ball is 23. Now if your ticket has all six numbers, you win over $20 million. Play on me. I think I just become a millionaire. God had answered my prayers. What? Kirby's here too? The ticket must have hit it for real. I rush there to rummage through the trash. And, here it is. It's mine. As if. Let's go ask Warren who this ticket belongs to then. Brilliant. And then give him a third of the prize? Do you really expect him not to ask for a share? Right. Okay, let it go and I'll give you a 30% share. Great ratio, but 30% is a perfect fit for you. I'll take 70%, and Danny. Oh, that's how you want to play. Fine then. How about whoever wins Danny's heart gets 70%? Deal! So we agreed to hide the lottery ticket in a trunk with two locks. Each of us kept one key to it. Then we buried it in a bush at school. Looks like the secret race between us starts now. Kirby wasted no time and brought Danny the showiest lunches ever. But he kept up his cold exterior and barely acknowledged her. Seems like I need a more delicate approach. So I told Mary to arrange a team-building game among the restaurant staff, in which we all had to answer the same questions to understand one another better. Oh look! He liked watching Star Trek, listening to Sam Smith, and reading Harry Potter like me! Oh, Danny boy, I told you we were destined to be a pair! Next question, what is the key to maintaining a long-term relationship? There's our very first answer. Feelings? Come on, Danny, be realistic. What uses do feelings have if you can't even afford to go on a date? Poor people can also be happy in love, but I don't think pragmatic people like you can. No, he misunderstood what I meant. After that, he ignored me completely. Worse still, kooky Kirby never left him alone. She even brought the whole cheerleading team to do this ridiculous routine while he was playing. Who cheers on a tennis court? She was going big, so I needed to step up my game. It's time to bust out my college savings. I spent the whole day at the mall buying him gifts and giving myself a makeover. This is the first time in my life I've spent my hard-earned money without considering the price. It feels so good, but at the same time, kind of bad. But I could make it up with the lottery money once I got Danny's heart. Look, I saw this watch and I immediately thought of you. I even met a professional tennis player at the mall. Can you believe it? And they told me this racket is the best. What do you think?
You're crazy. This costs thousands. Why are you doing this?
That's not the reaction I was expecting. But I like you, Danny. I've not been brave enough to tell you this because I had nothing. But soon, my life would change and I can give you everything.
I don't need those things. You're so wasteful and superficial. You really think money can buy anything, including feelings?
Why was he so mad at me? I thought he must have noticed that I'd worked really hard for all this and even made myself look prettier for him. Okay, he might not like my gifts, but is it so bad that I want to be a little generous to myself now that I have some money? Things got even worse when later I arrived at work to see Kirby booking out the entire restaurant to let her Danny take a rest and enjoy dinner with her. Fine, you win, Kirby. I give up. Nothing, basically nothing went the way I wanted. My luck, my money, my man. Now I'm fine with just the 30% God gave me. I'm done chasing anyone. Only my stray friends understand me. Muffin, Brownie, Oreo. Wait, where's Cupcake? Looking for him? Let him go. This wasteful, superficial girl needs to make sure he's not starving.
So you're the one who feeds them every day?
Why do you care? Go back to your date with Kirby. I'm just a materialist who thinks money solves everything.
I'm sorry for how I acted earlier. It's just that, at home, I'm surrounded by people who are all about money. So I hate that way of life.
Why are you talking like you come from money or something?
Yeah, kinda. My parents are the presidents of Sunland Corp.
What? The biggest furniture corporation in the city? Unbelievable! So why are you working part-time at a restaurant?
I want to earn my own money. An independent life suits me much better.
You're so silly. Why struggle if you don't have to? If I were you, my life would be so different. I'd make sure that my mom didn't need to work all the time to make ends meet. I could even go to any expensive law school I want and care for all the stray cats and dogs I find. Surprisingly, this time, Danny didn't look at me with jaded eyes like before. Instead, he just listened patiently and gave me the sweetest smile ever.
But not love. That's one thing money can't buy.
How about Kirby? Did any of her grand gestures impress you?
I prefer the cats.
Our talk has confirmed that there's still a chance for me. Kirby's only advantage over me is money. But Danny doesn't care about that anyway. Is that the new student? Seems like Danny just found a worthy opponent. He's Finn. Look how he smiles whenever his opponent catches up a point. Wait, did you just call Danny someone's opponent? Someone has a new crush. Who? Don't talk nonsense. Right then, a ball zoomed toward us. And holy moly, Finn caught it just mere inches from Kirby's face.
Are you okay?
She's fine. Her face always turns red. Nothing to do with a ball. Kirby was so embarrassed that she ran off. It seems our race took a turn. But then, shockingly, Finn turned to me and asked for my number? Huh? Does my charm glow this much? Everyone knew I liked Danny, but he's such a riddle. Maybe I could use Finn as my last card to make Danny jealous and bait Kirby to give up on our deal. What a genius I am!
Then, for the next few days, whenever Danny was around, I flirted with Finn and made sure Kirby saw us. One day, I made an excuse to borrow Finn's phone. Then I secretly used it to send Danny a message to stir up his jealousy. If you don't like Clarine, then let me play with this innocent girl for a bit. And Kirby also needs a kick to admit her feelings as well, right? Actually, I like you. Looking into your eyes, I know you also have feelings for me, so... And finally, I set a date for them at the tennis court tonight at 8. If Danny doesn't want me to get hurt and Kirby doesn't want to miss her true love, they'll show up. Then I covered up my tracks, blocked both our numbers, and returned his phone. Thank you so much. Are you free tonight? Come to the tennis court. I have something important to tell you. Oh god, Finn looks like he just won the Wimbledon. That night, Finn got there early and was really excited. Let's see who'll raise the curtain. Ah, it's Kirby. Oh, Finn, you had me at hello. But admitting my feelings means I lose the deal with Clarine, so...
What do you mean? What deal?
No, don't get me wrong. Actually, we won the lottery and made a deal to share it. Anyways, silly me. Money can compare to you.
Lottery? You two share it?
Why did she even mention the money? Right when it's getting messy, Danny turned up.
Bastard! Now you're two-timing?
Danny, why are you here?
He's just playing with you. This jerk is seeing both you and Kirby. Don't let him fool you.
I think Finn is a nice guy. Plus, I've told you how I felt, but you've never seemed to like me back. So Finn told me he liked me.
Clarine, I like you more than you know. Can't you see? I've given a lot of hints. I always make excuses to go home with you. I told you that feelings are the most important thing to me. As in my feelings for you.
Really? Idiot, how am I supposed to pick up those hints? So this daydreamer wasn't just imagining things? Turns out my plan actually did succeed.
Kirby, it's true, I do like you. But I thought you were out of my league, so I just wanted to ask Clarine for help.
Oh, how nice. Kirby, with a huge grin, then admitted I won. Then she dragged Finn away. I guess my biggest win is successfully pairing up two couples. The next morning, Kirby and I opened the trunk to get the ticket. When to our utter shock, Finn swooped in and snatched it away. While we were still processing what was going on, he ran off with our millions. But then, a shadow sent him tumbling to the ground. Danny?
I saw him following you two and knew he was up to something shady.
Then, Finn confessed that he transferred schools and approached me for the lottery ticket following his dad's order, who's none other than Warren. He knew it was a jackpot-winning ticket, so he set up a plan to steal it from me.
I'm so sorry. My dad's a gambling addict, which left him heavily in debt, and only this ticket could save him.
Oh, Finn, I believe he's not a bad person. This ticket was originally from Warren anyway, so we both agreed to give him a share to pay off his debt. Finn was moved and handed the ticket back to us. On learning this, Warren thanked us and offered to drive us to Tallahassee to claim our prize. He even carefully got me to double-check that my ticket was in my purse. But halfway there, the car suddenly broke down, so the four of us got out and gave it a push. But as we started pushing, Warren suddenly sped away, leaving all of us standing there in shock.
Where's your purse, Clarine?
I left it in the car.
That greedy snake Warren did this on purpose to run away with a ticket. Now what to do? Walk back home or walk to Tallahassee?
Calm down. Danny already has a backup plan. This is the real ticket. Enjoy the view for now. A taxi is coming to pick us up.
Actually, the moment Warren offered to drive us all the way to Tallahassee, I sensed something sketchy. So I swapped the tickets.
My dad's gone too far this time. He needs to stop gambling and work hard to pay off his debts instead.
Finally, we got the cash prize. However, the four of us decided not to divide it anymore. Instead, we're building a shelter for stray animals together. Surprisingly, our project soon reached many philanthropists, and now our fund has been expanded across the US. Since then, Kirby is no longer obnoxious. Now she even wants to become a veterinarian. And me? I will continue to work my way into the law school of my dreams. My hard work has really paid off because they just sent me an acceptance letter. I might not be rich, but in all honesty, it doesn't matter, as I couldn't be happier.
Hey, I'm Esther of the Rising TikTok channel at Aesthetic, where I share my passion for fashion. Look at my newest design. Cool, huh? Who would have thought newspaper was a great material for making dresses? I was trying one on and posing for photos when I heard a knock on my door. That's my mom and dad.
Esther, we have some good news.
We're moving.
What?
I'm being transferred to another branch in San Francisco. Can you believe we'll be living in that sunny city?
No, we can't move. I'm a senior already. All my friends are here.
Mom, just get over it and start packing. This is our one chance at a better life.
Why can't they understand that I'm not simply shy, but actually have major social anxiety? It's a real thing that I can't just get over. That's also why my 2 million TikTok followers still haven't seen my face yet. I could barely handle the stress from across the screen, never mind being alone in a brand new school full of strangers. Oh gosh, this place must be twice as big as my old school. It's gonna take forever to find the bathroom. Man, it feels like 1,000 eyes are on me. Or maybe not, but I can't risk looking around. What if someone makes eye contact? My palms are sweaty, my heartbeat is so loud I can hardly hear anything else. But then, some hot couple walked in and literally ate up the entire hallway's attention. Good, surely no one would notice me now. It was so exhausting running from one class to the next. Now, where do I sit? I walked over to a table, but no one batted an eye. I wasn't sure if I should sit down or not, when suddenly, a pretty girl appeared. Sky Blue.
Sorry? Anyway, you're new, right? I'm Jojo, class president. Come sit with us.
I followed her to another table.
Hi guys, got space for 2 more?
Yeah, sure, the more the merrier. Oh no, that girl doesn't sound too happy about having me here. But it would be too awkward to just get up and leave. Hi, I'm Esther.
Hey, didn't know they serve fresh tomatoes here.
Finish your lunch, Amanda. We have homework to do.
Phew.
Yeah, think about your homework, guys. Don't mind me. I got to know the school layout a bit better, so the next day wasn't as hard. Until I saw some girl waving at me. She looked like Jojo, but her eyes weren't blue. Must be her twin sister or a doppelganger waving at someone behind me.
You really just got ghosted in real life? And you call yourself class president?
I flinched. So that actually was the class president from yesterday? How strange! Then, my absolute worst nightmare came true in biology class. We had to work in pairs. Okay, which group would like a new member? Anyone? Please? Help a girl out?
I see you're in a desperate need of a partner, Zeke. Why don't you raise your hand so Esther can see where you are?
I saw an arm at the back of the class, so I walked towards it.
Hi, newbie. Esther, right?
My name is... Baby Blue Emerald Green?
Hey, do my eyes look funny to you, new girl?
Jeez, I didn't mean to upset him, so I ended up explaining that I'd had issues with eye contact since I was little. So my mom made me pay attention to strangers' eye colors to make it seem like I looked them in the eye. She even asked me what color their eyes were afterwards to make sure I did what she asked. Well, even though I did, that trick never actually helped me get over my social anxiety. In fact, I usually only notice other people's eye color, not their names or how the rest of their faces look.
You're weird, but I believe you. I don't like interacting with other humans either. They tend to pick on me because of my eyes.
It shouldn't come as a surprise that us shy kids got along pretty well. Zeke taught me biology and chemistry after class, while I helped him with his Spanish homework. Thanks to him, lunchtime isn't as stressful anymore. We could chat away about anime for hours, and he's supportive of my fashion obsession. So I felt comfortable enough to tell him about my TikTok account. He still liked to tease me from time to time, though.
Hi, reader. What color are their eyes? You know, the powerhouses, Colin and Amanda over there?
No way. I never look pretty guys in the eye, because I'll immediately turn into a walking tomato. Same thing for hot girls. I don't want them to think I'm trying to pick a fight with them or something.
You're that avoidant? Have you ever made eye contact with anyone here except me?
Yep. Jojo, the blue-eyed girl.
Blue? You know her eyes are brown, right? She likes wearing contacts. Jojo changes her eye color, hair, and accessories every week. She's quite a chameleon. Too bad she seems so smitten with that boring guy Colin Gray.
Wow, someone clearly has a crush on Jojo. But actually, I think Z could be quite a catch too, if he wasn't so insecure about his heterochromia.
Speaking of Jojo, have you heard about her Halloween party?
What about it?
Well, I thought about going, but I've no costume. Forget it. It's not like she'd notice me there anyway.
No! You should definitely go! I can help in the costume department! So, here we are! I'd successfully transformed my timid friend into King Lelouch. Who else but Seekin his unique eye colors could pull this off? As his personal stylist, he insisted I come with him. I'm not even dressed up, though. Oh man, I can hear my heart pounding already thinking about how many people will be in there. But I'm not the type to abandon my friend, so let's go. As soon as everyone saw His Majesty, they went silent, then erupted when he flipped his cape. Look at him! His ego must be through the roof right now. I then swiftly stepped back to a corner. So, this is what a house party is like. Suddenly, I overheard two girls talking. Aesthetic is definitely from our school, or Zeke had some connections. Yeah, I swear this is the exact same outfit Aesthetic has been prepping on her channel. Oh, come on. There could be hundreds of Lelouch costumes during this spooky season. Girls, please stop speculating. Aesthetic is totally not from this school.
Hey there, what's your costume? A shy, cute girl?
Nice Stranger Things shirt.
Yeah, I look even better than Eddie, don't I?
Yeah, totes. So I have this thing. Gotta go, bye! Then I ran straight out of there. That was too much socializing for one day. After that party, I noticed Zeke started to hang out with JoJo and became much more confident. I was happy for him, but he was no longer the same guy. One time, we agreed to study together in the library, but he stood me up. When we met the following day, he said he hadn't touched his homework yet because he was out with JoJo, and then asked to copy mine. Sure, fine, but when he was done, he flat out refused to teach me chemistry as he was too busy. Things were that way for a while, until today when I found out the shocking truth.
Esther, I only keep her around to do my Spanish homework. You know she's a total buzzkill.
Excuse me? Your free homework trial has expired. So much for we're friends, huh?
Everyone, look! Someone finally came to some self-realization. How adorable!
Tell them, Zeke!
Did you know she has to make her own clothes? Pathetic!
Who was this guy? He's the total opposite of the boy I'd got to know over the past couple of months. Am I in the upside down? It's over. Zeke and I were practically strangers now. Back to my gloomy and lonely life. Annoyingly, I saw Zeke again that day, this time on the school paper. This smug jerk gave an interview on the now-famous Lelouch look. However, in that article, JoJo claimed to be Aesthetic, the creator behind that costume, while Zeke backed up her entire story. What in the world? And JoJo even showed some of the sketches that I shared on my account. I was furious and went to confront JoJo, but somehow she didn't seem to be fazed at all.
So what if you're the real Aesthetic? I can be her too, don't you think? If you have a problem with that, then let's go sort it out. Attention everyone! This is Esther. You probably don't know her, but who cares? She has something to share. The floor is yours, girl.
Everyone's gaze turned towards me. Holy moly, where should I look? Why is this so different from talking to the camera? My entire body went into crisis mode. God no, something's coming up. Run! Although I calmed myself down, I couldn't face anyone right now. This is the worst day of my life. Suddenly, someone tapped my shoulder. Amanda? What does this social butterfly want? Did she just ask me if I was okay? Okay? No, I'm not okay. Why is it that girls like you and JoJo, who already have everything, always want to take away everything?
Hey, I'm just trying to be nice here. If it wasn't for my silly little friend.
What? What are you talking about?
Never mind. Sorry, but you don't seem okay. Come with me. I think I know how to make you feel better.
Come on! Skipping one class won't kill you, but bad mental health will. I wiped away my tears and went with Amanda, even though I barely knew her. But she had a point. The last thing I need right now is a stuffy classroom.
Here it is! Go inside. There'll be someone who can help you.
That's weird, but alright. I stepped inside, and it was like being hugged by the smells of wood and paper. It felt healing, for sure. I was browsing through the store, then saw Colin walk over. Startled, I stuck my face into an empty slot on a bookshelf to avoid him, but...
This place is filled with dust!
Surprisingly, Colin only smiled and gently wiped the dust off my face.
If you're looking for your girlfriend, Amanda just left.
She's not my girlfriend. And actually, I asked her to bring you here.
What? Why?
Just calm down. I got you something.
How do you know my favorite genre?
Because I've seen you read to calm yourself down before.
Turns out, Colin has been observing me from a distance for some time, so he even remembers what I usually read. He was hesitant to talk to me though, afraid that all the unwanted attention he might attract would make me feel uncomfortable. But now, everyone knows I like you. Sorry about that.
Don't be. It's my fault and my anxieties.
I can help you with that. Esther, would you go to prom with me?
How will that help?
It will. Trust me. Oh, his eyes are gray? I realized I've been talking to him all this time just fine without using the old trick. What if this guy really could help me?
On prom night, Colin drove me there. While he was parking his car, I waited in front of the venue. Out of nowhere, Zeke approached me.
Listen, there's not much time. You gotta listen to me. JoJo plans to give you an award, but it's only to get you to stand on the X mark on the stage where the trap door is. She wants to humiliate you in front of the entire school because you're with the guy she likes, so be careful.
What game are you trying to play here? Why are you telling me this?
I want to make things right. JoJo took advantage of my feelings for her, and I was too blind to see that she only liked Colin, and she's been using me to hurt you. This is my chance to make it up to you, so please, don't go up there. It's a trap.
Stop it already. I won't let you make a fool of me again.
Right on time, Colin came to the rescue.
Haven't you done enough? Stay away from her.
I'm truly sorry, Esther.
Inside, we were greeted by Amanda.
Congrats, bro. I'm finally free from the Colin's rumored girlfriend label. JoJo must be green with envy seeing how cute you two are together.
Right. She's here, as well as hundreds of other people.
Nope, I can't do this. I quickly crawled under a table and curled up into a ball.
Still, Colin remained patient.
You are absolutely stunning tonight. Honestly, your dress is amazing. Come out. Let the whole world see you.
The world will only laugh in my face.
Okay, then let me join you. It's actually quite cozy down here.
What are you doing?
Well, tonight is a special night, and my date's a special girl. So I figured we could totally enjoy it in an unusual way.
I feel like my insides just turned into a hot, liquidy mess. Who would have thought that I could meet someone who goes out of their way to make me happy?
We chatted for a while, then noticed that the lights outside were dimmed for the slow dance. Let's go. Hand in hand, Colin and I swayed to the melody, feeling like we were the only people in the room. Then, the music suddenly stopped. They were about to present tonight's awards for remarkable students.
And now, Best Dressed of the Night Award goes to Esther Crawford!
No way! What Zeke said immediately came to my mind. I turned around to see Zeke looking concerned and shaking his head.
Maybe he'd been telling the truth after all.
You don't have to go up there if you don't feel like it.
Colin was as understanding as always. But then I saw JoJo's smug face. I couldn't let her win again. So I mustered all my courage and stepped onto the stage, but steered clear of the X mark Zeke mentioned. Thank you, everybody. But I believe another person deserves this award much more than me. She's none other than our hard-working class president, JoJo.
That's so sweet of you, but it's yours. Please, step up to receive it.
You mean here?
No, one step forward.
Here? JoJo became impatient and rushed towards me.
No, you have to stand here!
Right back at you, JoJo.
Have a taste of your own medicine. Now that's some headline material for the school paper.
So, today is the day. My long overdue face reveal. This is such a beautiful dress, right guys? If you're wondering who this strange girl is, hi, I'm Esther, and I'm the person behind At Aesthetic. This dress right here, it's what I wore to senior prom. Settle in, I'm doing a face reveal and story time video.
I and Pearl were playing our favorite, playing Disney Princess. You have to be the princess this time, Ruby. We're gonna make a perfect Elsa and Anna. No, I'm going to be your knight, fighting all the bad guys and protecting you, m'lady. Then a maid knocked on the door with a phone in her hands. That might be my parents.
Ruby, the school called again. How on earth could you get all these words spelled wrongly? What kind of nurse is spelled with a Z?
I am really trying.
It's all right, bae. Studying isn't for everyone, and she might be of a sport type. Sweet Pea, could you just try a little more next time? Good girl. We have to go now. Bye.
I know you can do this. You just need to keep practicing. You're perfect, just the way you are. Hi everyone, I'm Ruby, and this is my little sister, Pearl. Since my parents were always away for business trips, it's always just been me and her, growing up together. You already know I was terrible at studying, but Pearl was nothing like me. She was a genius.
What are you doing, Pearl? For God's sake, it's 6 a.m. The sun is still sleeping, and you should be sleeping too.
Absolutely not. Today is my first day in high school, and I have to make a good impression. My streak must continue.
Straight A's since 2015, I know. As if your valedictorian title isn't impressive enough. I might be Ruby, the dumb kid who couldn't read half of a word, but it doesn't matter, because now I am Ruby, the awesome soccer captain.
Yes! Go, Ruby! That's my sister, everyone!
I led the school soccer team to win multiple trophies, and I also aimed at the varsity scholarship myself. Studying was still a nightmare, but I gradually accepted that I wasn't born for studying, but for soccer. So, all was well. So, that morning, I was walking with Pearl on her first day at school when Beth and her clique approached us.
Hey, Ruby, ready to flunk your junior year?
Aw, Beth, still salty because Coach left you on the bench yesterday?
My advice for you would be to learn how to actually play soccer. Unfortunately, some of us have other things going on to focus on, like our brains.
Oh, oops, you don't have one. You can't understand. Sorry.
Boo-hoo, funny. That's Beth on my soccer team who always messed with me, like everyone else. But all's good now, as I had my dear sister studying in the same school as me.
Sis, I found my class. I have to go now. Bye.
The next day at school, we had a new English teacher. Ruby Walker, could you read the summary on page 10?
Oh, screwed. Oh dear, is that your thinking face?
Didn't know you were capable of that.
Sorry, teacher, but she can't read.
You know what? My thoughts today on the book can be summarized into the classic song by the amazing Taylor Swift.
So the haters gonna hate, but I'm just gonna shake.
Shake it off.
Just then, the entire class was in a frenzy, and everyone was singing, dancing, like they were in the Eras Tour. The teacher was so upset and tried to calm everyone down, but I was sent to the principal's office immediately.
First trouble in the junior, huh, Ruby? Listen, both you and I know how much you mean to the team, but unfortunately, it is not enough anymore. New district laws state that students must average at least C- to be eligible for the varsity scholarship.
What? But I'm the most qualified for it!
I am sorry, but until you can move grades from whatever it is right now to a C-, you're off the team to focus more on your studying. Beth is now our candidate for the scholarship, and she'll take over your place.
Beth? That girl who scored just 5 goals all season when I had scored 20? The world was really getting crazy. No way was I going to watch my passion get taken away from me that easily. I'm gonna study hard. Right! I'm gonna ask Pearl to tutor me.
Ah, speak of the devil.
Hi, Pearl.
You know her. I heard she's kicked out of the soccer team because she's too dumb.
Oh, no. No.
How scandalous if our valedictorian did.
Well, maybe now wasn't a good time. That night, I dozed off at my desk writing 4 words over and over again. I am not dumb. The news had spread that I got kicked off the team because of my grades, and the kids at school were vicious with their insults.
Like I didn't have enough issues already, Pearl started to avoid me like a plague, as if she's ashamed of me. So I couldn't ask her to tutor me either. It's like the whole world was going against me.
The district superintendent was visiting our school, and the principal chose the 2 smartest kids to give a welcome speech, Pearl and a new student, Joe, from my class. So we started to hang out a lot at our home to prepare for the speech.
Hey, Ruby, need any help with tomorrow's test?
Nah, I am famously unteachable.
Don't waste your time on me, and Pearl is waiting for you.
It's all right, she can wait. Let me help.
Surprisingly, for the first time in my life, I felt like I could actually learn. There was something about the way he taught me that made me absorb knowledge naturally. Like, he understood me and my struggles. Hey, there you are. I've been looking for you.
We have a test coming, so I was helping Ruby.
And we have a huge speech to give on Thursday.
You know nobody actually listens to those speeches, right? Anyway, I trust you to come up with something incredible.
Pearl stormed out angrily, but the only thing in my mind then was that I actually could learn. Hey, Joe, please teach me more. Joe could help me learn to get better grades, and then I could finally get back to my team and win the scholarship. Later that night, when I was practicing some test questions Joe gave me, Pearl barged into my room. I am not comfortable with you spending time with my boyfriend alone.
Boyfriend? I didn't know you were dating.
Well, not yet. Not with you hogging him and not giving me space to charm him. Oh, sorry. I was just excited. Joe is an incredible teacher. I was actually learning.
Yeah, right. Of course you're capable of that.
Pearl left my room, and it felt like a knife went through my heart. Since when did she think of me like that?
like everyone else does, but she always believed in me. The next day was the speech, and even though I was heartbroken, I still went to support her, and I clapped the loudest after she gave her amazing speech. Thank you for granting us a chance to study here. On behalf of the whole school students, I'll try my best to bring glory to our school's tradition.
Wonderful speech, but I think before you bring glory to our school, shouldn't you teach your beloved sister, Ruby Walker, how to read first? I mean, maybe your dummy sister could learn one or two words from you before getting kicked out of her school.
The whole auditorium burst out laughing, and my rage was filling my body. I lunged at Beth and grabbed her stupid ponytail until she screamed so loud, even the moon could hear her. Teachers and guards tried to separate us, while other students were excitedly shouting and cheering. In the middle of the messy crowd, I saw Pearl look at me in shame. I ran to her, but she just brushed me off.
It's you again. Joe isn't enough, and now you try to steal my spotlight as well.
What? No, I never meant harm to you, I swear. But she didn't listen to me and angrily stormed off. I was so angry at my brain for always failing me, and at everyone. Now my dream was gone, and my dear sister hated me as well.
I fell down on the bleachers and saw Beth wearing my captain's armband, gathering everyone to the morning practice.
She waved at me with the widest smile. It was hard to fight the tears, so I let them fall. There you are. I was looking for you to continue our classes.
I don't think we should continue our classes.
Why?
Pearl, she doesn't like you and I together, and she will hate me for this.
Oh, I will talk to her, but this is more important. You need to get back on the pitch.
But you're just wasting your time on me. I'm just an idiot who ruined others' lives.
No, you're not an idiot at all. You're dyslexic, like me. I've noticed your symptoms for a while, but I wasn't so sure. But I am now.
Dyslexia? There's a name for this? So I'm not stupid?
No, you just learn differently. I will help you and teach you all the things the specialists taught me.
My mind was fuzzy. I gave Joe a hug without thinking. I felt relief spread all over my body. I wasn't dumb. I was dyslexic.
At home that night, I searched everything about dyslexia and even took an online assessment when suddenly Pearl barged in.
You told Joe I like him?
Yes and no, but not like that.
Well, thank you so much. He just called to tell me he just considered me a little sister. And you know what? I saw you hugging him on the bleachers this afternoon. So you were going behind my back all this time? What a sister! Don't ever speak to me again!
Pearl stormed out and kept her words of never speaking to me. It broke my heart to see us parting like this. Luckily, Joe comforted me and helped me stay focused on studying. Now that I knew what my problem really was and how to fix it, I improved every day. The letters didn't make me dizzy like before anymore, and our effort finally bore fruit as I got my first B- ever on a test. And in no time, I got called to the principal's office.
It has been incredible watching you turn your grades around. Good job, Ruby. I always knew you're a gem like your name, and you just need some sharpening. Welcome back to the team.
Thank you! I ran out of his office and rushed to find Joe immediately. We did it! I'm back on the team!
Congratulations, but that was all you.
You did it, Ruby. That moment would have been perfect if I could celebrate with Pearl. I knew she didn't want to talk to me, but I really wanted to share this with her. But upon seeing me and Joe, she was just shooting me death rays. The joy in my mouth instantly turned to ash. I just wished we could go back to the old good days together, but I had no idea how.
With me coming back to the team, I reclaimed the captain title and was eligible for the varsity scholarship. And of course, my impressive record easily got me the win.
Congratulations to Ruby Walker for winning this year's varsity scholarship. Come on stage.
Thank you very much, sir. All I can say is I'm immensely grateful for this chance, and I'm gonna try my best.
Hi, everyone. Ruby's too shy, so she did prepare a speech here.
Good luck.
Except that I didn't prepare this note. Everyone in the audience all locked eyes on me, and I was sweating all over when I took the paper from her. Today is
Oh, our scholarship winner just had a little problem. She just couldn't read.
I hope it won't affect the scholarship much.
Will it?
I ran out of the hall before the tears blurred my eyesight. Joe was racing after me, but Pearl caught me first.
Pearl, I don't really have time for your mocking now.
No, I'm sorry. Joe told me about your dyslexia, and you should...
You know?
Yeah, but it can wait.
But you need to go back there right now. You've tried so hard to earn this place. I wouldn't let my sister waste it just because of Beth's dirty move. Joe also nodded encouragingly at me. Pearl was right. It's my passion. It's me or no one who would claim it. So I walked back into the hall, and as soon as I appeared, everyone started to laugh. I stepped up to the mic, took a deep breath, and read the speech. There were still some stumbles and stuttering, but I went through to the last word. Hi, everyone. I'm Ruby. You all can see I have some troubles reading because I have dyslexia. All my life, I have struggled and accepted that I was stupid. Until now, I know I'm not. I still haven't figured out how to read big words, but I am not ashamed of my struggles anymore. And no one should bear the troubles I've had. Dyslexic people like me need others to help us, to acknowledge our difficulties, and to be given a chance like any others. We're not dumb. We just need a different way to learn. Thank you. The hall was completely silent for a while before standing up for an ovation. I walked away from the podium to see the scowling look on Beth's face. I went backstage, where Pearl gave me a warm hug. I'm so proud of you, and I'm sorry. I should have helped you, but instead I've been horrible or even cruel to you. Yeah, you've been forgiven. So now could you please just stay quiet? I just want to hold my little sister longer. I missed this hug. I missed Pearl. My Pearl. It's good to have my sister back. And just like that, my life was back to normal. Of course, with some changes. There's something I need to tell you, Ruby. I'm sorry for the Joe thing. I let jealousy take over me and said bad things to you, but I realized he and I would never become a thing. But you would. Huh? No, we're just friends. Are you? Now come with me. Then she dragged me to the living room, where Joe and another boy were standing. Then she placed my hand in Joe's. Joe, could you please take care of my sister when I go out with my boyfriend? sure.
I'm standing in the middle of the room, wearing this extravagant dress and a glittery mask. All eyes are on me, but I can sense how ingenuine they are. This is supposed to be my sweet 16th, and yet all of these guests were complete strangers. Ugh, it's all that slimeball Gregory's fault. Actually, this OTT party was all down to him. Oh, hi, I'm Vivian, but my friends call me Viv. My mom, Jacqueline Mars, is one of the wealthiest people on Earth. So I grew up thinking massive mansions, gigantic pools, and a floor entirely for toys was the norm. Well, at least I did until I turned 10. That day I was playing in my life-size dollhouse when I heard talking coming from the other side of the fence. I peeked over it and saw a woman and a girl around my age who looked kind of weird. Curious, I spoke up. Hey you, why do you dress so funny?
Pardon? What did you say?
You don't even have shoes on. That's so silly. You're the silly one. Bet you've never tasted this before, huh? So try it. Spoiled rich kids like you always look down on others. Well, in fact, you're no use to society.
I just stood there dumbfounded as the security shooed them away. I never meant to offend her. I was just curious. So I rushed inside the house to find Mom and ask her about this. Oh, honey, not anyone can be as wealthy as we are. That means you don't have to worry about a thing, sweet pea. Now go play so Mommy can work, okay? Even to this day, Mom's words still linger in my ears. I've grown to resent my family's wealth. I just wanted to be a normal kid. That's why, by the time I got to middle school, I convinced Mom to let me transfer from my private school to a public one and wipe out everything about me online, so no one would know about my influential family. I get the bus to school, buy clothes from thrift shops, and prepare my own lunch instead of bringing the gourmet dish the chefs make for me. A perfect normal life. Until Gregory, Mom's so-called boyfriend, showed up. He sticks his big nose in everything. Thanks to him, Mom wouldn't stop nagging at me about my clothing, my trashy public school, or how I gotta stop hanging out with the mediocre kids. Ugh, he is driving me insane. And to top it off, he gave Mom the idea of throwing me a 16th birthday party. I hate attention. Mom knows this. But what Gregory wants, Gregory gets.
This could be an opportunity to introduce her to society and gain new associates. It'd be good for her when she takes over business in the future, blah, blah, blah. Poof.
Please. The only thing that man cares about is himself and his associates, not mine. In the end, I agreed to a masquerade ball, on one condition. Mom has to stop interfering with who I should or shouldn't hang out with, especially my friends at school. And that brings us to the present. Right when the host announces that it's time for... my first dance? Huh? My what now? Ugh, Gregory! I was confusedly looking around to find a partner, when suddenly a hand grabbed me. Birthday girl, come dance with me. Ugh, what a creep. Let go! Can somebody help me with this? Suddenly a boy around my age appeared. Oh my. He has the most beautiful gray eyes I've ever seen. Excuse me, sir. I believe the lady has agreed to have her first dance with me. Thank you, handsome stranger. As we danced, I couldn't help but stare dreamily into those gorgeous eyes of his. We were about to leave the dance floor when he whispered in my ear, "Wait here, I'll be right back." Who would have thought a superficial party like this would lead me to my perfect guy? Suddenly, I heard a snapping sound behind me, and as I turned around, my mask fell off. Oh no, a paparazzi cut my mask string. I tried to cover my face with my hands, but it was no use. Luckily, Mom rushed over and hid me behind her. "Sorry, everyone, but the party's over. We had a great time and hope to see you all again soon." Then she led me back to my room, while the security showed everyone the way out. From that moment on, my ordinary life ended for good. My face was plastered all over the internet as the billionaire Jacqueline Mars's daughter. Now everyone at school is looking at me funny. I don't get it, guys. I'm still the same old Viv. Oh, there my besties are. They would surely have my back, right? But nope. As I approached them, they went ballistic on me, saying how I don't trust them enough to confess about my actual background, so from now on we're no longer friends. This is so unfair. I never asked for any of this. I wipe away my tears, trying to act like nothing happened. Huh? What's this? There's a note lying on top of my books that says, "Hey, it's me, the guy from your birthday party. I'm so sorry for what happened to you. If you need anyone to talk to, text me anytime." Oh, so he's from our school? Wow. Just when I thought no one's there for me, he showed up again. But there's no name, though. Is he still playing this mysterious game? Okay, I'll just call him my masked knight then. From that day on, we texted nonstop. He just gets me. My family situation, my friends, everything. One time he even secretly slid a Blackpink concert ticket in my bag, since I once told him that I was their diehard fan. Another time, he sent me a gift card to my all-time favorite ice cream store, Ben & Jerry's, just to cheer me up on a bad day. Aww. This ice cream tastes delicious, but I can't help wishing the masked knight was here with me. All I know is he has the most beautiful gray eyes and gorgeous black hair. Oh, speak of the devil.
Hey, I have a surprise for you this Valentine's Day. Hope you're as excited to see me as I am to see you.
Finally, I get to meet the boy I'm crazy about. I can't wait. On Valentine's Day, I was in English staring out of the window and thinking about my masked knight. I wonder what he looks like.
Ladies, I brought your Valentine's roses. Here you go, Viv.
This is it. It's gotta be from him. Happy Valentine's Day. Have a taste of the rose, then come meet me at the pool. X. I quickly unwrapped the candy, popped it into my mouth, then rushed to meet my dream man. Well, where was he? As I tried calling him, the room started to spin. I saw the outline of a blurred black figure, then... ugh. My head is killing me. Where am I? And whose hand am I holding? Hold on. Those eyes. He must be.
Thank goodness you're awake.
Are you the one
who danced with you at your birthday party? In the flesh. I'm Jeremiah, by the way. I had higher hopes for our first face-to-face meeting, but oh well.
Turns out, he always knew I went to the same school as him, but he was a bit intimidated by my family's influence, so he decided to get to know me via text first. He said the cops had found some sort of sleep-inducing substance in my rose candy. Before I could quiz him anymore on this, Mom barged into the room and hugged me. After making sure I was okay,
She turned to Jeremiah and said, "You saved my daughter. For that, I can never thank you enough. Please join us for dinner tomorrow night." Jeremiah seemed hesitant at first, but then he nodded in agreement. The dinner did not go as planned. Between Mum's blatant interrogating and Gregory's menacing looks, I could sense Jeremiah's discomfort. Then when Jeremiah asked where the restroom was, Gregory insisted on showing him. When Jeremiah returned, he seemed flustered and made his excuses to leave. Gah! What had that annoying Gregory said to him? I quickly followed Jeremiah and apologized, but he just smiled and offered to pick me up for school tomorrow.
"The cops haven't found the culprit yet, so from now on, I'll be your guardian."
How sweet. After that, I hung out with him every day. Great, right? Only, somehow it didn't feel the same as when we were texting. Back then, we had a deep connection. Now it was just like two friends hanging out. Oh, and not to mention Olivia, Jer's childhood friend who can't seem to leave him alone for more than 2 seconds. One time, Jer and I were at the movies together, but guess who coincidentally appeared and plonked herself down next to him? Yep, Olivia. Worse still, with their giggling and popcorn sharing, I felt like the third wheel. I was not having this again. So I just left for home in this random cab parked outside the theater. But bad luck. The driver doesn't know the way. He doesn't even have a phone. And I had to lend him mine for GPS. The guy snatched it out of my hand immediately. Rude. But wait, it was 9 p.m. already. Why did he still have shades on? And even wore a mask? Right then, I realized the car had passed the town's border. Stop! The car suddenly filled with smoke, and the last thing I thought was, he has eyes that were exactly like Jer's. I woke up finding myself in this old, cobwebby room. Where is this place? And that driver guy? I have to get out of here now. Right at that moment, he came into the room with a smile.
"Don't you recognize me? Will you have another dance with me? 'Cause I'd love that."
What is happening right now? What he just said? Did that mean he's the actual masked knight? Maybe that's why I don't feel connected to Jeremiah. Why did Jer lie to me then? So many questions popped up in my head. Then suddenly I heard a car stop outside. That guy immediately went to check. This could be my chance of escaping. By the time I got downstairs, I saw the driver guy talking to Jeremiah. So I hid behind the door and watched on.
"Cameron, just stop this. Getting revenge on our father is one thing, but this is a step too far. Take Viv back to her family now and end this. I know this looks bad, but trust me, I'd never hurt Viv. I didn't mean for her to fall into the pool. That's why I jumped in to save her. But I need her as bait to show the world what that jerk Gregory is like. He doesn't deserve to be her father."
I muzzled myself in shock. Gregory is their father? And that Cameron guy was the one saving me, not Jer?
"Don't you forget who abandoned us when Mum had a close brush with death, then took all our business and properties, even our home, leaving us helpless? That jerk deserves all he gets."
I was trying to process it all when another car arrived. Gregory's. I quickly hid under the stairs before he walked in with a bunch of bodyguards.
"Cameron, Jeremiah, my sons. Haven't you grown up so fast? Cut to the chase. Give us back the business and what's rightfully ours. Then we'll let your stepdaughter go." "Huh, indeed. Like father, like sons. Very smart. But still amateurs, my boys. You see, all that girl is to me is an obstacle blocking my way to the inheritance. So please, be my guest and take care of that little Miss Annoying."
"Aren't you afraid we'll expose everything you just said?"
"And who's gonna believe you now? Jacqueline is mesmerized by me, so she'd believe anything I say."
That snake. How dare he speak of my mum like that? Unable to hold in my rage, I jumped out of my hiding spot and screamed at Gregory. "What did you say about my mum? You slimy, lying traitor."
"Nice talking to you all, but the fun has to end here. Goodbye."
The guards lunged forward, about to tie me up when the cops smashed the door coming in, and behind them was Mum!
"Stop right there.
How dare you do this to my daughter?
Gregory's face turned paler than a ghost as he mumbled out,
Jackie, honey, why you're here? But just in time to save our baby, Vivian.
Cut the act. I already heard everything you said. And you're going to jail for a long time. Then the cops led him and took his crook guards away. Seeing Mum, I was so happy I rushed to hug her. Turns out, her investigations of the pool incident led her to Cameron. So when she confronted him, he eventually told her everything. That's how they came up with a plan to catch Gregory red-handed. Mum and the cops had been waiting in ambush around here for Gregory to show up. Then, well, you know the rest. A lot has happened in 3 months. Mum finally finished all the legal stuff, so now the property Gregory had merged with hers to gain her trust is now signed back over to Cam and Jeremiah. I realized that being wealthy isn't a bad thing, especially as it means with influence like this, I can help other less fortunate people and really make a difference. Now I help Mum with her business and her charity work, and I'm really enjoying it. I'm proud of my hard-working, amazing Mum, and I'm proud of who I am. And guess what? I now have real friends who like me for me. As for Jeremiah, well, he apologized about everything. He used to fear his brother was going to hurt me, so he lied to protect me. We made up, of course, and became the best of friends. I'm not sure I can say the same about his brother, though. He did everything he could to beg for my forgiveness, but I just can't. Then one day, Jer asked me to come by his home to visit his mom. She begged me not to think badly of her boys, especially Cameron. He's in love with you, you know? He always talks about you and how he wishes things would have been different. Oh boy, her words are starting to have an effect on me. When I walked out the door, I saw Cameron sitting on the porch. He turned and looked at me, and I felt my heart pound for my gray-eyed, masked knight. So, taking a deep breath, I walked over to him, just as the sun was setting.
Oh God, my Roger, look at him! Those chiseled features and dreamy eyes! No wonder every girl swoon at the sight of him, and of course, me, his biggest fan, is no exception. You're probably wondering how I got into the backstage area of a star actor like Roger, right? It's simple. His makeup artist is Hannah, and she just so happens to be my big sister. Of course, I had to beg her for days to let me tag along. That's why I have to embrace every second of being this close to my celebrity crush.
Hey, are you taking pictures of me?
Oh no, busted. I was stammering, trying to come up with some excuse, when to my surprise, Roger lifted my phone and took a selfie.
Here you go, baby girl. Next time, just ask.
Oh my, there's no denying that Roger is boyfriend material. The girls from my class will definitely be turning green once they know this. Oh, he wants some orange juice? No problem, Roger. Just call me your own personal genie. Then I rushed around to find some OJ and hurried backstage to give it to him. But too late, his other fangirls had beat me to it. There were enough juices for him to drink all year round now. Sadly, I turned around to leave, but accidentally bumped into someone. Holy moly, it's Roger! He smiled at me and looked down at the cup of fresh orange juice in my hands.
May I borrow your OJ? This is my number if you need it.
What does this mean? Have I, an ordinary girl, caught the eye of the hottest guy on the planet? Ouch! This is clearly not a dream! For the rest of the evening, I tried composing the perfect message to him. Ugh, why was it so hard? I must have typed and deleted it at least 100 times. Oh no! I just pressed the send button by accident! Before I could remove that message, he already replied. That's it. There's no turning back now. I tried to calm myself down and went with the flow, which then led us to hours of long conversation. And soon, we were talking every day. One day, out of the blue, he said he wanted us to have a private date. Does that mean our relationship has moved on to the next level? Our first date was at this low-key diner with very few customers. I disguised myself just like what Roger told me to and waited for him. But it's been an hour in vain. Did he really stand me up?
I glumly got up to leave when a sweaty, out-of-breath Roger appeared. Turns out he struggled to lose his security guards just to come and see me. Aw, it's so sweet that he went to all this effort for a normal girl like me. No need for a fancy restaurant nor extravagant gifts. This diner was already the most romantic, as I had a real gentleman right here. Don't wake me up from this dream ever. Then, before we parted, he gently put a daisy bracelet on my wrist.
Dating in secret is pretty exciting, right, babe?
Oh boy, this proved that I was no longer just a mere fangirl having a crush on her idol. Yep, we were officially dating in secret. The next day, I arrived at school in the best mood ever. I was singing on the way to class when my friend Alba startled me. Hey, have you watched the new trailer for Roger's upcoming film? It's dope. I booked a ticket for the sneak show already. That's nothing. I already got a slot at the movie premiere. Jealous much? Huh, that's the power of a fan club's vice president. And for me, I just had the most romantic dinner date ever with Roger. Oh, of course, that's only what I wish I could say. In fact, I could just smile and then head on to my seat. Keeping this secret is driving me crazy. But I guess dating an idol comes with a price, and I don't mind paying for it my whole life. But okay, on top of all the secrecy, as y'all know, celebrities are always occupied, having no private time left. So we have to come up with inventive ways to get some alone time. Finally, Hannah had left. Let's see, hair, makeup, clothes, everything was perfect. No one seemed around. Now I needed to hurry to Roger's van. Hey, Hannah, why are you still here? Wow, look at you, all dressed up, huh? What's the occasion? I just forgot my stuff. See ya. And then I rushed behind the vanity van. Phew, so close. It's a good thing I look a lot like my sister and have picked up some great makeup tips from her, so it's a piece of cake for me to pretend to be Hannah and sneak into the filming site.
Let me see if you're my adorable Harper.
While praising my excellent disguise, Roger suddenly went silent. Then he turned into a completely different person. His attitude changed. He pushed me away, poured his coffee onto his shoes, and started yelling at me.
What on earth are you doing? Do you know how much these cost? Clean them!
What just happened? I reached my arm out and asked if I'd upset him, but a woman swung my hand away.
Take your filthy hand off my son!
Oh, it's Roger's mom, Mrs. Walker, the chairwoman of the film production company, known by the entire industry for being a bossy lady who always caused others difficulties. Worse still, the buzzing sound outside also started growing louder. Oh no, I better not cause any trouble here. So I kept my gaze at the ground and frantically apologized. Suddenly, a hand grabbed my arm and pulled me away. It was Danielle, Roger's manager.
Don't be bothered too much if he acted a little off. It was just too stressed from work. I'm Roger's older sister, by the way. We were super close, so I understand him better than anyone.
OMG, I didn't know he had an older sister.
But I know about you. Every time he sees you, his eyes fill with happiness. It's kind of obvious. You don't have to say anything. I'll keep your love story a secret.
It turned out that Danielle knew everything and didn't say a word because she knew it would embarrass us. After that, she drove me home and we exchanged numbers. Roger wasn't being very responsive, so it was nice having Danielle to talk to, as she was very supportive of our relationship and kept me up to date with the schedule. A whole week has passed since that day with no reply from Roger. Nothing. Not a single phone call. I also texted his new phone number that Danielle gave me, but still zilch. Sometimes, I don't know if I really have a boyfriend or not. I just want to experience what other couples have.
Stop wasting your time fantasizing about a guy far out of your league. It's so tragic, especially now he has a girlfriend. He's totally betrayed us.
What did she just say? Girlfriend? I hurriedly went online and saw a photo of Roger and Jessica, a hot singer, looking cozy backstage.
So he was ghosting me to be with her?
My heart felt like it was going to burst into flames.
I immediately texted Danielle, and she replied straight back, complaining that she was also having a headache with Jess's dirty PR tricks to promote her new album. Oh, phew. So it's just a silly rumor. What a relief. Besides, for the past few days, Roger hadn't contacted me at all because he'd been busy filming a new movie in Paris. He would be back soon, and he was gonna hold a small meet and greet downtown. Danielle suggested I should show up and surprise him, and she even cleared up Roger's schedule that day so we could go on a date after the event. Wonderful, Danielle! That day, I went to the meet and greet and disguised myself so perfectly that Roger wouldn't recognize me. He would be so surprised to see me here. To be honest, I don't like my man doing all those kinds of air kisses or hugs with fans, but, well, that's his job, and I should be understanding. Besides, I used to fall for these sweet gestures as a fan too. Roger, are any of these dating rumors true?
Well, I just thought, you know, I'm better off focusing on my work and you guys. You're my true supporters, unlike all the girls out there who only approach me for fame and money.
What does he mean? So he just sees me as one of those clout-chasing girls out there? I seemed to be out of breath among the excited howls of his fans, and I couldn't stay here much longer. I was sobbing as I ran outside, thinking about how Roger actually thought of me, of us, all this time. Suddenly, a car stopped in front of me. It was Danielle.
I know it's hard being in love with a celebrity, but from a fan's perspective, that's something they want to hear from him. Of course, he can't speak up about his real relationship, but you can.
You mean there's nothing wrong with your love, and we have plenty of other ways to express it discreetly, right? What Danielle said got me thinking. Sophie teases me every day for dreaming about dating my idol, but this relationship is real, and I have the right to show off my love, right? So, I posted my favorite picture from one of our dates on Instagram as a way to pour my heart out. The next morning, I woke up to see an angry text from Roger.
Harper, why did you break our promise? Why did you disclose our relationship? Things are a mess now.
Underneath, it was the link to a tweet along with a title, Young Actor Roger is suspected of dating someone 10 years his senior. Oh no. How did they find my photo that quickly? And worse, they must have mistaken the person in the picture to be my sister, Hannah. Well, at least my sister is on vacation, so she hasn't found out about this yet. I must fix this before she comes back, or else she's gonna kill me! I tried to contact both Roger and Danielle, but got no response. What to do? Ah, Roger is having a press conference for his new movie. I'll go there and talk to him directly. I use Hannah's pass card to rush backstage in the hope Roger would be there, but wait, there's only Mrs. Walker and her staff.
You better clean up this scandal immediately. Don't let it affect the conference.
So annoying. That makeup artist must be using some tricks to take advantage of Roger. Now she will know what it's like to have her career ruined. Oh no, I can't let that happen. Please don't do this. It's not Hannah in the picture. It was me, her sister. Roger and I are in love.
I never said I loved you, so stop making a fool of yourself. Sorry, Mom. I was just playing around with her because I was bored. Let me handle this.
What? I thought he was different. Turns out, he's just another jerk who uses fame to flirt with girls. We're over! I shouted, then sprinted out of there. For days after that, more Twitter videos were posted from Roger's alleged staff claiming he was arrogant and rude. It serves him right, I guess. However, I began to wonder about the fact that there weren't a lot of people there at those moments. Who could have been the one taking those videos? Suddenly, a Twitter notification popped up and brought me back to reality. Wait, it's that account, isn't it? The fans were still furious with Roger. Scrolling through the articles about him, I saw a bunch of comments telling everyone to cancel him. They even shared a picture of Roger going to bars and getting drunk the night before his apology press conference. Even though I was mad at him, I couldn't just switch off my feelings. So I took an Uber to the bar to find Roger, but because of my age, the security guard stopped me. As I was trying to find a way to sneak inside, I saw a familiar figure. It was Roger, sitting on the steps of the bar's back door. Hey, you alright? I'll call Danielle to come pick you up.
No, please. I'm too tired of having bodyguards and a manager follow me 24/7. I just want to be alone now. Harper, I'm sorry for hurting you all this time. I just want to say, it was real. I really do love you. I did what I did because I was so worried that my adoptive mom would harm you if she knew about us.
Your adoptive mom?
Yeah, I'm not Mrs. Walker's biological son. She recognized my acting talent, so she adopted me when I was 11. Since then, I've been nothing more than a money-making machine to her.
He then told me how his pure passion for acting was starting to be worn out by all these pressures of being a celebrity, especially now that he knew someone was behind all the recent scandals. I know who's behind it all, so do show up at the press conference as planned, and I'll take care of the rest. I waited for Roger to finish his apology for all the scandals, then I went up to address the crowd. All of the rumors are fake. I know this because I'm the girl from the video. And the person who filmed and edited it to make it look bad was his manager, Danielle. I pointed to her, and amidst the gasps, all eyes and cameras shifted to her.
What?
This is slander. You have no proof. Then I held up my phone and played a video recording of Sophie admitting that Danielle was giving her the videos to upload on the internet. Actually, on the presentation day, Sophie accidentally revealed her secret Twitter account, which was none other than @cancelRoger, the one of the so-called staff. So I confronted her right away and told her that she could be sued for defaming others. When I first heard the rumor about Roger having a girlfriend, I was blinded by jealousy, so I listened to Danielle. Given that she's his manager, how could I not believe that those videos were true? As his fan club vice president, I had my members' best interests at heart, so please, don't sue me.
Fine, it was me. So what? I need to show Mom that Roger's not as special as she thinks she is. I knew Roger liked Harper, so I approached her and used the relationship to ruin his career. Then Mom would finally notice me.
Whoa, what a twist, right? So what now?
Well, Mrs. Walker and Danielle's true intentions were exposed for all to see. This cleared Roger of all the scandals, and his fans are all back together to support him again. He has a new manager now, and they have no problem with him publicly dating me. Oh, and as for Hannah, arriving back from her trip to discover she'd been dating one of her celebrity clients didn't go down too well with her. But it's not all bad, since she now has loads of bookings after this scandal. So if anything, she has me to thank for being more in demand than ever.
Hi, I'm Addison, but all my friends call me Addie. I'm just an ordinary girl who doesn't have any particular talents. But there is one thing I do have. That is... Oh, why don't we just watch the video to see what it is? This is my older sister, Olivia. She's beautiful, isn't she? She's also an amazing singer and has a talent for art. She can pretty much draw anything. I mean, I don't know how my parents could have such a perfect daughter like her, then have me. But I'm fine with that. Olivia was all about winning trophies and medals. Well, I was happy with the ice cream and ton of snacks my parents gave me for getting a B on my math exam. Hey, Addie, my baby! Guess who's got some new trendy clothes? Oh, Mom, Dad, I don't like these things. Why are you buying so much? It's such a waste of money. However, Mom's desperate look made me cave, so I reluctantly grabbed a random item and went to try it on. Oh, it's a crop top. I stared at myself in the mirror. Okay, so my parents' dumbfounded expressions made their feelings pretty clear. I looked ridiculous. See, I told you already. I'm way too short to wear tops like this. Right at that moment, Olivia walked by. I immediately ran over to her. I think you should have this top. It'll bring out your nice figure. You'll look so cute in it. Mom shook her head. No! If Olivia wears this, everyone will see her navel. Isn't that the point of crop tops? Then Dad chimed in.
Anyway, Liv, where are you off to in such a hurry? It's not that nonsense model club again, is it?
Speaking of clubs, is the school dance club still recruiting? You should join. You'll get in for sure. My sister rolled her eyes, then left, slamming the door behind her. I loved my sister, but she just seems to find me annoying. She was like the Ice Queen, always shutting me out. She never allows me to borrow her clothes or to touch her stuff. And if I ever try to go into her room, she freaks out. It's not that she's mean as such, but she tends to act like I don't even exist. It's okay. I mean, I'm kinda used to it. I live my own life and she lives hers. So that's why when I got my first cell phone and started to use social networks, I didn't try to search for her profiles, though I knew she was on all those platforms. That evening, my mom asked me to go upstairs to call Olivia for dinner. No answer. So I began pushing the door open. She suddenly appeared from the bathroom and yelled, "Hey, what are you doing? You know you're not allowed in my room." "I knocked, but you didn't answer. Mom says it's dinner time." She hissed at me and shooed me away. Ugh! Why did she have to treat me like I was some pest? The way she was so weird about her room was annoying. Maybe she was hiding something in there? Nah, probably I was just overthinking this. Olivia was always like this. Life went on, and my sister, well, she continued to distance herself from me. But then one weekend, I walked downstairs to find her cheerfully humming a song as she danced around the kitchen. When she saw me, she smiled and said, "Morning, sis. Come sit here. I made you breakfast." Okay. This was weird. I cautiously sat down and kept looking at her. Why are you so happy? And where are Mom and Dad?
Mom and Dad just rushed off on some work thing.
Then she put the plate in front of me, grinned, then continued.
Mom made cookies this morning and told you to take them to Grandma's. Tell her I said hi.
Oh, you're not coming with me?
No, no can do. Sorry, I've got work to do.
She continued to look at me and I got the feeling she wanted me to hurry up. Before I'd even finished my toast, she passed me my jacket and bundled me out of the door. Having no choice, I made my way to Granny's while in deep thoughts about how odd this was. Until I realized that I didn't even have the cookie bag with me. I'd left it at home. Gosh! I immediately rushed back. But, why was there a strange car parked outside my house? I lingered back and watched as a middle-aged man got out of the car. Before he even got to the door, Olivia opened it and smiled at him. I dove behind a bush so I could carry on watching. Huh? Why was he handing her flowers and a gift box? She happily took them from him and even leaned into his ear and said something. Oh my God! So this explains my sister's strange behavior. They're a couple, aren't they? I never thought that my sister would be interested in an old man like this. Shocking! But wait, what if he's deceiving her? As Olivia may look sharp, but she's actually very innocent. If that was the case, I would beat him black and blue. But this was just my speculation. I can't hastily act without knowing the truth. So I decided not to let them know that I was there, and quietly entered the house through the back door to get the cookie bag. Later that day when I arrived home, my sister was back to her Ice Queen self. She was cooking in silence, so I told her Grandma said hi, and she just grunted, then carried on stirring her soup. I needed to find out what was actually going on. The perfect opportunity arose a few weeks later, when Mom and Dad went away on a weekend trip. I told Olivia I was meeting some friends for a picnic, but this was a lie. I actually hid in my faithful hiding spot and watched. As expected, the old man showed up and Olivia let him inside. The door was ajar, so I tiptoed inside and heard them laughing in the living room. I peeked in, and to my astonishment, my sister was sitting on the couch wearing the weirdest outfit ever. It was those kinds of clothes that only catwalk models wear. And most of all, she had this heavy makeup on and looked like a totally different person. The strange man was sitting next to her. Both of them were looking at her phone and laughing happily. Oh gosh, Now everything was clear. From her reserved nature, to her seem-to-be-secret room, it was all so she could continue to hide this age-difference love story. I didn't know how to react now. I just kind of felt bad for her because she had to hide it. I mean, this was her home, and we were her family. We might not have been close, but she was my big sister, and I wanted her to be happy. If this love was real, then I fully supported her. And if this guy turned out to be bad, well, then I'd protect her to the end. My parents returned that evening, so I set up a family movie night. A great idea for family bonding, right? I chose a romantic movie in which the main actress is much younger than her boyfriend. In the middle of the movie, I turned to my parents and asked, "Mom, Dad, if you were their parents, would you allow that relationship?" They gave me confused looks. Then Dad immediately asked,
"Hey, Addie, don't tell us that you're in love with an old man, huh?"
This startled me, but before I could say anything, the doorbell rang. I was about to go open the door, just to avoid answering Dad's question, but Olivia was faster. Not long after that, she turned back and shouted at me, "Addie, how dare you touch my phone?"
"What's up, Liv? Who's at the door?"
"Go ask your dear daughter, Addison." She gave me a dirty look, then stormed up to her room. My parents immediately bombarded me with loads of questions.
"What's happening here? Who was the one ringing the bell? Why that manner of Olivia?"
Okay, the one who rang the bell was Olivia's boyfriend. So, earlier, when Olivia left her phone in the kitchen, I noticed that there was a message from a man named Henry Davis. I immediately searched for him on Facebook and found out that this was the same guy who'd been visiting her. So, I used her phone to text him, telling him to come around at 8 p.m. I thought it would be better if Olivia could make her relationship public with our parents. But, Hayes, it seems she didn't take it very well. Anyway, now I had no choice but to tell my parents everything. Their faces dropped, and without saying anything, they ran upstairs and banged on Olivia's door. But there was no reply. Instead, all of us heard a rattling sound from the back door, and Olivia had fled. Our parents' faces turned red, while I felt so guilty as I not only wasn't able to help her, but only worsened the situation. The next day, Olivia still hadn't returned. She also didn't show up for school, which caused my parents to freak out. Then I suddenly thought of Henry. Right. Why didn't I think of asking him from the beginning? So I immediately contacted Henry and asked him to help find Olivia. That afternoon, when I just got home from school, I saw Henry driving off. There was a note stuck to the door saying Olivia was fine, with an address below. And it also said if we come there at 9 a.m., we'll see Olivia. The next morning, we showed up earlier than scheduled. Huh? It was a studio. And just like Henry said, Olivia was there. She looked so glamorous and was so busy prepping for a photo shoot that she didn't seem to notice us. Henry welcomed us and started explaining everything that made my parents, as well as me, speechless. Turns out, the truth was far from what I thought. He was not her boyfriend. Instead, he's her manager. He saw Olivia's potential and guided her to become a photo model and a TikToker. The flowers and gifts were from the brand she was working with. And the other day, she wore that outfit and makeup for a TikTok video. After the shoot was over, we walked over to her. But she took one look at us and ran away. I managed to catch up with her, then said, "Sis, why didn't you just tell us the truth? We're your family. We'll always be on your side." "On my side? Really? You have no idea what it's like to be an outsider. It doesn't matter how many competitions I win. I'm invisible, while you get praised for just getting an okay grade on a math test. I want to be a model, but they don't want that for me. They want me to be miserable. I'd rather leave that house to do what I love." I was dumbfounded, and so were Mom and Dad, who by this point had caught up with us and heard everything she'd just said. Dad hugged Olivia. Then in an emotional voice said,
"Olivia, it's not that we forbid you from doing what you want. We were just worried for you. We just know that this industry can be complicated, and we don't want you to get hurt.
That's right. And it's not true that we love Addie more than you. You just excel at everything, and we just didn't want Addie to feel insecure. We're really sorry, Olivia. We all love you.
Oh, no, Mom. Don't worry. I never felt that way. Actually, I've always admired Olivia. And it made me sad when she ignored me. Olivia burst out crying, and our whole family hugged each other tightly.
Sorry to interrupt, but you must have had some idea about Olivia being an internet star already, right? I mean, it's easy to tell from her social networks.
I shyly said, I don't follow any of her accounts. I thought she just wanted me out of her way. Henry then patted my head and showed us Olivia's social media accounts. And wow, she had millions of views and followers. We all watched some of her TikTok videos together, and she totally rocked it. Seeing how much this meant to her, my parents came round to the idea of her being a model, and they even thanked Henry for helping her. Then Olivia came closer to me.
Hey, Addie. I'm sorry for being so cold in the past. Turns out, you love me so much and will support me regardless. At least now, if I really fall in love with an old man, I don't have to worry, right?
Then everyone laughed. Oh, even though my plan didn't, well, go exactly as intended, I still call it a success, because it all ended out great in the end. You thought it was all finished, huh? Nope, not yet. There's one more thing I want to show you guys. That night, for the first time, Olivia let me go inside her room. Wow, it was like a mini studio with expensive flashlights, a ring light, and a camera. And her clothes and makeup collection were super impressive. Oh, do you remember what I said at the beginning of the video about being an ordinary girl? Well, that hasn't changed. But now I can confidently say that there is one thing I do have, and that's an awesome big sister who loves me unconditionally. I wonder what's taking Valerie so long. She's been in that changing room for ages. Valerie? Is everything okay in there? Don't force it if it doesn't fit. No, this is the last dress in store. I just need to breathe in for a bit longer. So? It's beautiful, isn't it? Valerie spun around. Then suddenly... Yep. Trying to squeeze into a dress two sizes too small for her, then it split. The giggles around us started. Valerie blushed, hurriedly paid for the dress, and pulled me out of the shop. Why am I so fat? Ugh! I just want to feel pretty on my date. If I was skinny like you, I wouldn't have this problem. Poof! You know, it's not as easy as you think being thin. Yep, you heard me right. Being thin has its downsides. First of all, fashion. My nightmare. I have to wear an extra small size, and the clothes still hang off me. Actually, most of my clothes are from kids' stores, so I feel so untrendy. Then in winter, I have to wear tons of layers just so I don't freeze to death. And in the summer, I can't wear cute clothes as I look like a coat hanger. Not only that, because I'm so skinny, people often ask me to do nonsense stuff. Once, I was studying in my room when suddenly I heard my sister Camilla calling me. She'd forgotten her keys and forced me to climb through her tiny window gap to get them. Seriously, I can't even! Then, on another occasion, Valerie made me crawl into the classroom locker to help her cheat on her Spanish test. Unfortunately, the teacher walked in while this was happening and gave me a week's worth of detentions, of course. Ugh! Oh my god, No Way Home is so good. I literally can't think of one bad thing to say about it. Yep, the part near the end. Ah! Yep, guess what? I'd managed to trap my foot in a manhole. Man, what rotten luck. I tried pulling my leg free, but it was no use. It wouldn't budge. There I was, freaking out that I'd be stuck here forever, and all my friends could do was huddle together and ask me questions like,
Madeline, how on earth did you get your foot in such a small slot?
Wow, that's unbelievable! Even Jaden, my bookworm friend, took out a ruler from his backpack and started measuring how wide the slot was. Grr. My dear friends, I'm being stuck down here. Stop gawping and help me! Finally, they tried helping me out, but in the end, we had to call the rescue squad. By this point, a massive crowd had gathered around me, and strangers were filming me. When I was finally free, everyone looked at me and held back their laughter. Even Parker, my crush, was smiling. Jeez, this was beyond embarrassing. But a hot guy like Parker would never notice a moving skeleton like me anyway. Don't think like that, Maddie. You're so pretty. Show me some confidence, would you? Valerie said as she nudged my arm. I put the book down and glared at her, and suddenly noticed Parker walking towards our table, smiling. And yep, he said he wanted to sit with us. Even though I was cheering inside of my head, I still had to act composed. And oh my god, can you believe he even said I was cute? After that day, Valerie kept on encouraging me, saying he had definitely given me a green light. So finally, I gathered my courage to write down all my feelings for Parker on a note and clipped it to his notebook. At the end of class that day, he came to my desk and took my hand. Yay! Everything was fine, great even, until one day when the two of us were taking a romantic walk past the Swan Lake, Parker suddenly turned to me and said,
You're so beautiful, Maddie. And if you just put on a few more pounds, I swear you'll be the hottest girl at school.
Yes, I know, but it's hard for me to gain weight.
No big deal. Just leave it to me. I'll fatten you up.
I thought Parker was just joking, but it turns out he was being deadly serious. Since that day, every time we went on a date, instead of taking me to the bowling alley and movies as usual, Parker would take me out to eat. I swear, I've tried all the restaurants in our town. More surprisingly, on my birthday, Parker even gave me a bouquet of fried chicken. How romantic! But this didn't change anything, as my weight still stayed the same. Parker was disappointed when he peered over me and saw the scales hadn't budged. Then he sighed out,
How come you and Valerie are friends, but look totally opposite? Here comes our adorable, chubby Valerie!
What? Parker called Valerie adorable again. This wasn't the first time either. Annoyed, I put down my fork and walked away from them. After that, I started avoiding Valerie. I did homework with other friends, sat with other girls at lunch, and every time I happened to see Valerie, I turned around and walked away. Honestly, I didn't want it to be this way, but just seeing her made me uncomfortable. But I couldn't bear to see my boyfriend call my BFF cute, while he thought I was too skinny. Then summer break finally rolled around. I thought it'd be just me and Parker, but then he went off to a summer camp in Spain. The plan was all ruined. So I spent a whole sunny day inside sulking.
What's wrong? Are you bored because your lover is away? So why don't you take this time to surprise him when he returns?
Surprise? A great idea popped into my head. But how do I get chubby?
Easy peasy.
Okay, if it's that easy, then show me.
Okay, if you do my summer homework for me.
What? She's such an opportunist. But I really wanted to pile on the pounds and please Parker. So, without hesitation, I nodded in agreement. So, from that day on, I started following Camilla's weight gain plan. I switched veggies for greasy foods, and my main meal was always late at night. I also changed water for milkshakes, but I did have to stop drinking them when the smell of milk alone made me feel sick. Seeing me eating crazy like that, my parents worriedly said,
"Madeline, eating healthily is important, else your health will be affected."
But I ignored their advice. This time, I definitely had to gain weight. Finally, after a month of trying, I gained some weight. Yay! I looked a lot more attractive now, didn't I? I was studying myself in the mirror when I heard my phone beep. It was Parker. He was coming over tomorrow with a present for me. The next day, I put on this hot dress that I'd never felt confident enough to wear before, and I asked Camilla to help me do my makeup. As soon as I finished, I eagerly waited for Parker in the living room. The doorbell rang. I excitedly opened the door, but as soon as he saw me, Parker quickly said,
"Oh, sorry. I have the wrong house."
Then he started to leave. Huh? He didn't recognize me? This will be fun. No, honey, you're not mistaken. It's me. Your destiny.
Madeline? Is that really you? Oh my, how on earth can you be this big? We've only been apart for a month.
So, you don't think I'm prettier now? To my surprise, Parker shook his head.
No, no, you're so fat now, it doesn't look okay. Lose some weight.
Huh? This was so confusing. I thought he wanted me to be bigger. As annoying as this was, I still listened to Parker and tried to lose the weight I'd put on. So, it turns out that losing weight is far trickier than it sounds. Actually, it's a million times harder to lose it than it is to gain it. After a month of healthy eating and exercise, I gained another pound! Ugh!
Stop eating that! Are you giving up already? You must try harder!
What? It's just some popcorn. Why does he have to be so rude about this?
I'll give you 2 weeks to lose weight, else we're done.
Huh? What did he just say? Done? He was the one who wanted me to gain weight in the first place. Now he was threatening to break up with me if I didn't lose it. How ridiculous. You know what? I don't need 2 weeks. Let's end it right now. It's clear you never loved me at all. You only like my appearance. If you truly cared about me, you wouldn't care what size I was. Then I walked off. Ugh, how could I have been so stupid? For the entirety of my relationship with that jerk Parker, I was blindly following him. I only cared about pleasing him, and it cost me so many things, including my best friend. I needed to apologize to her right away. I nervously knocked on the door, then waited. Finally, Valerie opened it, but on seeing me, she went to shut it. "I'm so sorry. Just let me explain, please." "Valerie, I'm so sorry. It was all because I was afraid Parker would leave me for you. But I realize now that he's a massive jerk, and I was an idiot for ever trying to change for him." "Jeez, you're crazy. Parker is totally not my type." I scratched my head and told her about how terrible Parker had treated me and how I'd foolishly listened to him. "Man, that douchebag!" Then she hugged me. Valerie confessed to me that she'd been trying to lose weight by lowering her calorie intake, but the pounds weren't coming off. And worse still, she felt weak and tired all the time. I nodded in agreement with her. So, from then on, Valerie and I made a promise to love ourselves, regardless of what size we were, and to never let anyone try and change us. And look, that's Walker and Joel, our awesome boyfriends who love us just the way we are. And you know what? It feels so good not caring what other people think. So don't ever let idiots put you down. Because when you allow yourself to just be you, then you can finally realize just how beautiful you truly are.
I was taking an interesting-looking book from the bookshelf when suddenly I saw a face peering back at me.
Wait a minute. Oh God, not him!
I quickly hid my face behind a book, but too late. He'd already seen me.
Duh. What was I thinking? Now I looked even more pathetic. You must be wondering why I was desperately avoiding this dude. Well, this wasn't just any dude. It was my ex-boyfriend, Owen. Talk about a day ruined. Oh, hi, Owen. I didn't see you there. Are you here by yourself?
Oh no, I'm here with my girlfriend. There she is. Hey babe, I'm here.
I turned around and... Jeez! My day just went from bad to catastrophic! How on earth did they end up together? Yep, I knew that girl. She's Mila, my stepsister! Oh, let me tell you about her. Actually, before we became stepsisters, Mila and I went to the same high school together, but we weren't close or anything. But out of the blue, my mom and Mila's dad somehow got together and soon got married. I tried being friendly towards her, but no matter what I did, she remained cold and unpleasant towards me. She even forbid me from telling anyone at school that we were family. And she started to compete with me for team tryouts, in tests, everything. Then one day, after a few months of living together, she informed our parents that she was moving in with her mom and switching schools. Why, you ask? Well, 'cause she couldn't stand living with me anymore. I'm not gonna lie, hearing her say that hurt like crazy. All I'd been was nice to her, but fine. If that's what she wanted to do, then whatever. And like I said, that guy over there is my ex, Owen. We used to date when I was a sophomore and he was a senior. But then he dumped me for the most ridiculous reason ever. Well, back then, I was on a strict diet. Every time we went out for some food, I would order a depressing-looking salad, and Owen would order a delicious hamburger with fries on the side. So, I always snuck a fry or two from his plate, and a couple of bites out of his burger. But I mean, sharing is something totally normal in a relationship, right? But, well, Owen didn't think so. So just like that, he ended things with me, then went away to college. But now he was back in town for summer break, and he was dating my stepsister. Ugh! Oh, hey Amy. Long time no see. Oh yeah, I hope you don't mind, but I'm with Owen now. Ugh! I hate her sarcasm! And did she have to latch onto his arm and stroke his hair?
What about you, Amy? Are you seeing anyone at the moment?
There was no way I was going to tell them I was single. That would be so embarrassing. So, I flipped my hair, then started bragging about my awesome older boyfriend. A mature guy, who has the face of a movie star and the body of a Calvin Klein model. Wrinkles started to form between Mila's eyebrows. In your face! But then Owen suddenly said,
"Great! How about a double date tomorrow night?"
What? Great idea, babe! I want to meet the lucky guy who stole my sister's heart. My God, they weren't joking. Ugh! I had no other choice but to agree. Darn it. Where was I going to find a handsome older guy by tomorrow?
Amy, are you trying to wear away that table?
Oops. I'd been so preoccupied with my dating dilemma, I hadn't realized I'd been cleaning the same table for 20 minutes. Hey, but wait. I took a closer look at my manager's face. Jake is handsome, older than me, and he's single. My God, I'd found my fake boyfriend! Now I just needed to persuade him. But he's way too serious to help with this stupid situation. I did know he was on the search for his perfect girlfriend, as I'd overheard him complaining about the disastrous dates he's been on. Cue my perfect plan. After we closed the coffee shop, I volunteered to clean up so I had an excuse to stay late with Jake. Hey, Jake. My boyfriend Owen has an intelligent, gorgeous-looking sister who I want to introduce you to. At first, he wasn't interested, so I showed him Mila's prettiest picture.
Holy moly! That's his sister?
Jeez, why so surprised? Mila is not that beautiful. Whatever. At least I had his attention.
I asked him if he wanted to go on a double date, and he immediately agreed. Yes, jackpot! So my plan worked. But the only issue was that my fake boyfriend thinks he was on a date with Mila, and that I was with Owen, when in reality, they were actually both together. But no worries, I could pull this off. Right? So for our double date, we all went bowling. Jake took an instant liking to Mila and tried to impress her with his bowling skills. Me, on the other hand, sucked at bowling and got constantly teased by Owen. So when it was his turn and he misjudged his throw and threw the ball straight in the gutter, I had loads of fun teasing him back. To be honest, I was enjoying hanging out with him. And please, don't get me started with his looks. He's definitely grown more handsome with time. Suddenly, it was my turn again, and Owen was asking me if I wanted him to show me how to throw a bowling ball correctly. I timidly said yes. So he stood behind me, touched my hand, and showed me. Oh my God, my whole body was heating up, and I could feel that Owen was blushing too. Hang on, I think I still have feelings for him. Mila didn't deserve him. He should be with me. Overall, the double date was a big success. Jake didn't suspect a thing. And not only that, but he also helped keep Mila away from Owen so that I had a chance to win him back. But then a few days later, Jake told me that he really liked Mila and asked me if I could set them up on a date, but this time only the two of them. What? He actually liked Mila? Of course, I couldn't set them up. It was impossible, because Mila was with Owen. So, reluctantly, I suggested another double date. He agreed, but this time he insisted that we went out for a romantic dinner. Fine. Everything was okay at first, but then Owen placed his arm around Mila while she fed him some of her mashed potatoes. I glanced over at Jake and saw the dumbfounded look on his face. I needed to separate them quickly, so I asked Mila to come to the bathroom with me. Oh, Owen is such a great guy. He's so thoughtful, and he always treats me like a princess. Ugh, she's so annoying. Well, enjoy him while you can, because he would soon be mine again. When I walked out of the bathroom, Jake ran over to me and dragged me into a corner. Owen and Mila are really strange, don't you think? Are you hiding something from me? What? I would never. They're just close siblings, that's all. Oh, and by the way, I talked to Mila in the bathroom, and she thinks you're a great guy. Of course, that was a big fat lie. If I was Pinocchio, my nose would be as long as an entire baseball bat. But at least Jake was buying it, because he looked so thrilled. We went back to the table and continued this so awkward dinner. Suddenly, Owen and Mila started calling each other Buttercup, Cutie Pie, and other disgusting nicknames. Jake and I just sat there with super awkward faces.
Hey, Mila, you and Owen seem to be pretty close. Have you always been this way?
Of course. We just can't get enough of each other, can we, sweet stuff?
She looked at Owen with dreamy eyes and kissed him on the cheek. Yes, on the freaking cheek! I looked over to Jake and, yep, he looked so horrified, but maybe he hadn't figured out they aren't siblings. Ugh, who am I kidding? Of course he'd figured it out. After the double date, he yelled at me for tricking him. I explained to him that I really like Owen and that I was trying to win him back.
What about you? Do you like Mila?
Jake silently thought for a minute, then nodded. He really likes Mila a lot. So I suggested that we should team up to break the couple up. And Jake agreed. I told Jake that Mila is into photography and also has professional equipment. So he messaged her asking if she could take photos of the coffee shop for his online page. And Mila said yes. While that was going on, I turned into a complete creep and followed Owen just so I could accidentally bump into him at the bakery. Then we had some croissants and talked about the old days. I thought it would be fun spending a whole day with Owen, but no. On the contrary, it soon began to get boring, Kinda annoying, even. Turns out, his personality hadn't changed at all. He kept his food out of biting distance of me and still told the lamest jokes. Listen to this. What do you call a sad coffee? A depresso. Now I regret buying him that coffee. Maybe I should reconsider this. I mean, do I really want this boring guy back? Then he told me he was planning a special surprise for Mila, and he wanted to discuss it with me over dinner at his place. When I was in the kitchen helping him to cook, he suddenly lunged forward and tried to kiss me. Huh? What? I was so startled that I threw some carrots in his face. Oh my god, my plan actually worked and Owen had fallen for me. What about Mila? I thought this whole meeting was about a surprise for her. And that was when Owen came clean to me. He had no surprise planned for Mila. That was just a ruse to get me here. Also, turns out the time we met at the bookstore wasn't by chance. Owen had been stalking me. What? Creep! He also knew that Mila was my stepsister, so he purposely got with her to make me jealous.
Amy, it's you that I love. It's always been you.
What? Hearing him say that gave me the shivers. Well, now at least one thing's for sure. Any feelings I thought I had for him had 100% evaporated.
Letting you go is a big mistake. Please come back to me. Mila means nothing to me. I don't care about her at all.
Oh, wow. Owen is a massive jerk. How dare he take advantage of Mila's feelings like that? Ugh, I needed to warn her. But before doing that, I had to give him a piece of my mind. Let me make this clear. I only went on a double date with you guys because I didn't want to lose to Mila. Nothing else. May I remind you that you're the idiot that split up with me? Oh, and your jokes are really lame. And that's it. Owen just stood there with a bewildered look on his face, and I left. I ran straight to the cafe shop where Mila was and blurted out the whole truth about how Owen was just using her to make me jealous. I can't believe you're doing it again! What do you mean by that? Don't act all innocent. You're stealing my boyfriend again! Huh? What did she mean by again? Turns out back then, Mila had a crush on Owen. So, when Owen and I started dating, she got real mad. And that's why she was always so cold with me. I didn't know. I swear. If I knew that, I would never have dated him. Ugh, just stop. I know you can't stand losing to me. Just leave me alone. I don't want anything to do with you. I give up. Talking to her was pointless. But then Jake suddenly spoke up.
Mila, she's trying to protect you. If she didn't care about you, then she'd just let you be with that jerk. But no, she told you the truth even though she knew you'd probably react like this. Because that's what sisters do. They protect each other.
Mila fell quiet for a bit, but then realized Jake was right. So we sat together and had a long, serious talk. There were laughter, tears, and copious amounts of hot chocolates, but in the end, we finally seemed to understand each other. So that was it. After all the drama, Mila and I put aside our feud and made up. At first, Mila was kinda sad about what Owen did to her. Luckily, Jake kept her company, and she soon opened up to him, and their relationship developed. And now they're dating. Yahoo! About me, I may still be single, but I'm okay with that. The main thing is that after all these years of hating and competing, Mila and I made up. I don't have a boyfriend, but I have something better. I have my sister back.
Admit it. Come on. You took my necklace, didn't you? Mindy looked at us and shook her head. She was sweating. Well, there are only three of us in this house, and if Andy didn't take it, then obviously it was you. Seriously, Cass, you got to believe me, I didn't take it. But clearly she was lying, because when I rummaged through her bag, Cass's necklace was right there. Cass told her to get out of her house, and Mindy burst into tears. Poor Mindy. I really wanted to stop Cass, but she seriously hates people touching her stuff, so I just kept quiet. You see, Cass and I are pretty much joint at the hip. We've always lived in the same neighborhood, so we grew up together and shared everything. Well, almost everything. Except one little secret that would probably ruin our friendship forever if she found out about it. Auntie, what are you doing? I started to stammer. This is so cute. Honestly, I'm so upset about Mindy. I can't believe she'd do something like that. I smiled, not knowing what to say. I mean, it was me who'd exposed her. Suddenly, I felt so guilty. Right at that moment, we got to the checkout. Cass took everything out of the cart to give to the cashier. Hang on, she exclaimed. What is this? This item has the barcode ripped off. The cashier made a fuss for a while and even called the manager. Cass and I stood there for ages, trying to figure out what was going on. Cass even started crying, thinking she'd be accused of shoplifting. After about 30 minutes, the store manager came and told us we could leave. They kept the items that had no barcodes and sent us on our way. Phew, that was close. What? What do you mean? Oh, nothing. I'm just relieved that we didn't get into any trouble. Just so you know, though, that wasn't the first time we'd got ourselves into an awkward situation while out shopping. Sometimes it was the torn barcodes, sometimes the tags were missing, then the security alarm would always go off at the door. And all of these situations weren't just coincidences. Okay, I gotta be honest here. The thing is, I have a habit of pilfering. Not because I can't afford stuff. I mean, my dad's the owner of a bank, so money isn't the issue. My dad basically buys me the latest phone every month. And you should see my wardrobe. I have all the designer bags. I steal because it gives me the kind of thrill that my boring daily life just can't give me. My dad just hands me money every day and never stops to think that maybe I'd like a hug or a how are you. Ever since my mom left when I was just a baby, he's been using money as a way to keep the peace. So one day when I was in elementary school, I stole a hairpin from the girl who sat next to me. It felt so good, like my own little secret. I loved the drama that came with it, and the fact that no one ever suspected me, because I was such a rich little girl. After the hairpin, I got addicted to stealing little things and couldn't stop. It felt like the only thing I could control in my life, and so I kept on doing it. And here I am now, still getting a buzz from it every single time. And yep, you've guessed it. The one who took the necklace at Cass's sleepover was none other than me, of course. But at that time, because I was so scared, I slipped the necklace into Mindy's bag and pretended to find it there. I was deep in thought when suddenly Alex's scream startled me. Guys, I've lost my unicorn pen. You know the pen that glows? The whole class was suddenly in uproar. Some friends were trying to look for it. Meanwhile, Alex was walking straight towards me. Andrea must have taken it. This morning when I took out the pen, me and her were the only ones in here. I looked up at Alex, my heart pounding in my chest. This is it. I'm so done this time. Then I suddenly looked over at Scott Parker, the cute boy who just transferred to our class. Oh no, I couldn't give him a bad impression of me. I had to quickly think of a way out of this. You waited until I went to the bathroom to take it, didn't you? Alex, I'd never do such a thing. Besides, I have loads of nice pens. In fact, you can have one if you'd like. I pulled out a beautiful pink rhinestone pen from my pencil case and handed it to Alex. While Alex stared in awe at my pen, I suggested everyone go check their lockers to see if her pen was there. Sure enough, right by the lockers was the glowing unicorn pen she'd lost, right in front of Scott. I picked up the pen and handed it to Alex. I'm so upset you thought I'd steal this from you. But it's okay. At least we found it. Alex blushed and apologized to me. Our other friends also blamed Alex for not looking for it carefully enough and for jumping to conclusions about me. Next time, don't be so silly. Andrea's a good person. Besides, her family is so wealthy. Why would she need to steal a pen from you? I just smiled and walked away. Suddenly, a voice called out from behind me. It was Scott. He looked at me and said, Wow, that was totally dramatic. I'm Scott, by the way. You're Andrea, right? Sorry if this is a bit forward, but here's my number. Excuse me? Am I dreaming? Of course I texted him as soon as I got home. He said he was so impressed with how I'd handled being blamed for the whole thing. Soon we were chatting every day, and eventually he asked me to be his girlfriend. I was so happy. But there was just one small problem. Ever since we'd started dating, I felt really ashamed about my bad habit of stealing things. I was determined to give it up, but it wasn't going to be easy. One day, Scott came to pick me up and asked if I wanted to go to the bookstore. A bookstore? No, I don't want to go there. Can we go somewhere else? Please? Seeing me panic like that, Scott looked puzzled. Then he suggested we go to his place to watch a movie, which I was fine with. Hopefully there would be no temptations for stealing there. A middle-aged woman opened the door for us at Scott's place.
Oh, this is Sandra, our maid.
Hi, Sandra. I'm Andrea. But instead of saying hi back, Sandra just stared at me in a seriously creepy way. It actually sent shivers down my spine. After watching the movie, Scott and his mom invited me to stay for dinner. Scott's mother, Mrs. Doris Parker, was really sweet, and we had some interesting chats. While waiting for dessert, I got up to go to the bathroom. But as I stepped out there, I almost bumped into Sandra. She was just standing there staring at me again. Sorry. She didn't say anything, but just kept staring at me in this weird way. Oh my gosh, why was she looking at me like that? The next morning at school, Scott told me his mother had just lost a valuable ring. She had a jewelry tray next to the bathroom sink, and after washing her hands, she'd forgotten to put her ring on. After dinner, the ring was no longer there. I comforted Scott, then made an excuse to go to the ladies' room. I needed to seriously think about this. Honestly, I'd tried my best to not get the urge to steal at Scott's place, but when I'd seen Doris's beautiful ring, no, I had to find a way to return it. No one could find out about this, and I had sworn to myself that I would never let this happen again. Hello, Where's Sandra? Oh, she was fired. Mrs. Parker said Sandra had stolen her jewelry. Anyway, may I help you? Oh, no. I had to return this ring immediately. Poor Sandra. Scott came down for me and said he'd make dinner. I glanced through the window to find Doris was having tea in the garden. This was my chance. I snuck up to her room, quietly tiptoed in, and headed towards her jewelry box. Suddenly, the light came on. Tell me what on earth are you doing here? I quickly turned around, dropping the ring to the floor. Mindy? Why are you here? I'm Scott's cousin. So it was you who stole the ring. I can't believe my cousin is dating you. Hearing the noise, Scott and his mom ran upstairs, while I was still dumbfounded and speechless. It was you who stole Cass's necklace too, wasn't it? She won't even speak to me because of you.
I'm so sorry. I know it's not okay, but I couldn't stop myself. I've been feeling so guilty, so that's why I'm returning it. I was still kneeling on the ground when a hand reached out to me and helped me stand up.
I'll handle this. Come on, let's have a chat outside, shall we?
Turns out Mrs. Parker is a therapist. She could see I had a problem and offered to help me. I told her how guilty I'd been feeling about Sandra getting fired and asked Doris if she could call her for me so I could apologize. 30 minutes later, Sandra arrived. As soon as Doris saw her, she apologized and offered her the job back. But no, ma'am. I was the one who stole it, and I deserve to be punished. I'm sorry. Sandra, I've already confessed to Mrs. Parker that I stole the ring. I didn't mean to get you fired. I just couldn't help it. You didn't do anything wrong.
It was me? I was greedy? She is innocent.
What on earth is going on? Obviously, I was the thief, so why was she defending me? Why are you doing this? Do we know each other, Sandra?
And that's when the truth came pouring out. Sandra was my mom.
Yeah, I don't know how this is possible either. So according to her words, she'd had a huge fight with my dad when I was a baby, and she'd fled to another city where she found a job working for Scott's family. When they moved to Seattle, she came with them. Even though she was nervous about returning back to where me and my dad were, she'd carried so much guilt about leaving us, and never in a million years did she expect to bump into me at Scott's house. I was so shocked, I couldn't even speak. I'd imagined this moment my whole life, and now, here I was, standing face to face with her, and she'd even taken the blame for me. I couldn't believe it.
Mom, I'm so sorry that I stole the ring. I can't believe you're really here.
Sweetie, you don't need to apologize. I'm the one who will be apologizing for the rest of my life, abandoning my daughter like that.
What kind of mom am I? How will you ever forgive me?
We stood there, hugging for what felt like forever, and I knew in that moment that I'd never steal again. Doris diagnosed me as having kleptomania due to a lack of love for my mom. But now that my mom was back, I had no reason to seek out those thrills from stealing. I had everything I needed right here. There were a few moments where I almost stole again, but Doris told me to call my mom as soon as I felt the urge, and when my mom picked up the phone and I heard her voice, the urge faded, and I felt so much better. Scott and Cass and Mindy forgave me after Doris sat them all down and explained more about my addiction and where it stemmed from. Now, Scott and I are still together, and I see my mom every day at Scott's place. My dad hasn't forgiven my mom for leaving yet, but baby steps. Finally, I feel like everything is complete, and my pilfering is a thing of the past.
This view of the Alps is magnificent. Wow, I've never felt this free before. Huh? Hang on. Are those meowing sounds that I'm hearing? I followed the sounds to the raging river nearby, and there, stuck on a rock in the middle of it, was a terrified cat. Oh no, poor baby. I've got to help it. I quickly grabbed onto the nearby tree, then leaned out towards the rock with an opened umbrella on the other hand for the cat to jump onto. The cat hesitated for a bit before making the leap, but it's heavier than I expected. I lost my balance and tumbled into the river. I grabbed the cat just in time, but the strong current made it impossible to float. In a panic, I screamed for help, but the waves lapped over me and gulps of water filled my mouth. And just like that, I felt my surroundings darken. Ugh. What was this wet, scratchy thing rubbing on my face? I opened my eyes to see that cat sitting on me. Thank goodness it was okay. But where am I? This seemed like some kind of rustic cottage house. Suddenly, a man walked into the room with a food tray. Who are you?
Relax. I'm the one who jumped into the river to rescue you both.
Turns out he happened to pass by the river while we were swallowed by the current, and he didn't hesitate to jump in to save us. Then brought us back to his home. Thank you for everything.
Sure. Here, eat up. So, how come you and Topaz fell into the waterway?
Who? Oh, you mean the cat? How come you know his name?
It says it right here. See? I'm guessing this is not your cat, then?
I told him how I accidentally found Topaz, so its family must live around here somewhere. Hearing this, he agreed to help me find Topaz's owner the next day. He even gave me his bed for the night, then walked out saying he'd sleep on the couch. But as a guest, I couldn't let him do that, so I just grabbed the blanket and went to sit next to him. You have a cool tattoo there. Kinda looks like a mini Mars, right?
Nah, it's my birthmark. The only thing my parents left me.
Hans then told me that he grew up not having a clue who his parents were or why they abandoned him. At 18, he moved out of his foster home and came here to become an herbalist. I felt so bad for him, and in a way, I could relate. Being alone is difficult, but having both mom and dad won't guarantee your happiness. I was born into a well-off family with both of my parents, but the thing was, they only got together due to an arranged marriage, and they have resented each other ever since. My house always felt so cold and empty, and I hated staying there. So, as soon as I graduated high school, I took a gap year to travel the world. Actually, Switzerland is my first stop. Gotta say, it's nice to have someone to talk to like this. I guess Hans felt the same way by this look he gave me. He seemed very touched. The next morning, we took Topaz to the town to ask around. Turned out, today was their annual festival, so a horde of people crammed along the street to celebrate and watch the parade. Hans held my hand so I didn't get lost, but somehow the crowd still pulled me away and I ended up stuck among these sweaty people. Suddenly, a hand grabbed mine and led me out of there. Phew, thank God, I couldn't breathe in there. And you know what? A super handsome, stylish guy was standing in front of me.
Are you okay?
That's when I noticed the tail of my shirt was ripped. Freaked out, I tried to cover it up, so he took out a silk scarf and tied it around my waist. For a second there, I froze to the spot. So amazed by his thoughtfulness. Just at that moment, my phone buzzed with a call from Hans. He told me to meet him at the fountain. Slight problem? I had no idea where that was. Well, lucky me, this gallant guy offered to take me there. We talked along the way, and I found out his name's Willard. He lives in a nearby town and was here for the festival. I told him I came to find the owner of the lost cat I'd found. Then, when I showed him the picture of Topaz, he couldn't hide his shock.
Are you sure this is the cat you found?
I nodded. He stayed silent for a while, then said,
I might know its owner, but I gotta go now. Bring the cat to meet me there. Faye, it was nice meeting you.
Then he bowed down to kiss the back of my hand before he left. How sweet! I watched as he disappeared into the crowd. Thanks to Topaz, I got the chance to meet him again.
Why are you making that funny face?
I told him about my encounter with Willard and convinced him to come with me to the address on the handkerchief. He seemed skeptical at first, but then gave in. I mean, other than this, we had no clue. It was worth a shot, right? The next day, we went to the place Willard told us. But seriously? Is this right? Why were there a line of people all holding near-on identical cats to Topaz? They even had the same collar as him. What is going on? I walked over to ask an old man sitting on a bench. He told me the millionaire lady who lives here had lost her dearest cat, Topaz. People said his name was on the top of her inheritance list, and she promised to greatly reward anyone who safely returned him, so these frauds were trying to deceive the owner by bringing some Topaz lookalike here.
But Madame Primrose is no fool.
Huh? Madame Primrose? The iconic designer and president of Wisteria Fashion Corp?
That's right.
Oh my god! I immediately dragged Hans to stand in the line. You see, my childhood dream was to become a fashion designer, and, of course, the one I admired the most was none other than Madame Primrose! Ah! One of the reasons I came to Switzerland was to find her and hopefully become her apprentice. And now look, what are the odds? Finally, it was our turn, but...
I'm gonna have to stop you right there. All right, everyone, listen up. Madame Primrose won't accept any Topazes from now on, as she's tired of your deceit. So, disperse.
What? We didn't just wait half a day here for nothing. Fine, I'll find another way to get in. We then walked around the mansion and found its side gate. Then, just when we were climbing over it, a maid caught us. But she didn't make a fuss out of it. Instead, she seemed a bit flirty towards Hans. Ooh, I had an idea. There's our chance. You go and charm her. He seemed confused at first, but then got the point.
Hey, I think you're really cute.
Hans then tried his best at flirting, and as soon as she swooned, I asked her to help us return Topaz to his owner. The maid hesitated at first, but when we said that we didn't need to be repaid or anything, she agreed to let us in. We quickly split up to find Madame Primrose. I wandered the maze-like hallways. Then I suddenly bumped into someone.
Mind your way! Wait, I don't know you. What are you doing here?
She's my new friend. Is there a problem?
I'm sorry, young master.
It was Willard. He came to rescue me again. Great to see you again, young Master Willard. You live here?
Why didn't you call me when you arrived? Did you bring the cat? Where is it? Give it to me right now!
Willard, calm down! Topaz is safe! I just found out his owner is Madame Primrose and—
I'm her grandson! Just give the cat to me now!
His agitated behavior didn't seem right. I took a few steps back from him, refused to do what he said, then ran.
You don't understand!
Just at that moment, Hans and Madame Primrose appeared.
There you are! Are you okay?
He worriedly asked. But boy, all I could see right now was Madame Primrose! She approached me, held my hand, and repeatedly thanked me for risking my life to rescue Topaz. This was amazing, but why did Willard just leave without saying anything? Madame Primrose invited us to stay for dinner that evening. Joining us were Willard and his mom, Agneta. Madame then told me how much Topaz meant to her. 20 years ago, she lost her son, Mr. Alvarez, to a car accident. Then a year later, her grandson Leroy disappeared. Her grief was almost unbearable, but then she was gifted a cat, Topaz, and thanks to him, she began to heal. I tried comforting her by saying she still had Willard, her other amazing grandson with an excellent fashion sense inherited from his grandma. But to my surprise, Madame Primrose said Willard isn't her real grandson, since Agneta is actually Mr. Alvarez's second wife and was a stepmom to the missing grandson Leroy. And Willard was her son with her ex-husband. I could see Willard and his mom were feeling so uncomfortable. Willard must have felt so hurt as Madame Primrose never even thought of him as a family member. Then my train of thought was interrupted by Hans. Ugh, why didn't he just tell me to pass him the salt instead of sticking his right arm to my face like this? Suddenly, Agneta gave him a mortified look and spilled wine all over the table.
Mom, are you okay?
She didn't reply, but just left. I could tell it was because she saw Hans's birthmark. What could this be?
Has she no manners?
She must be unwell. I'll go check on her. So I followed her to the garden gazebo. That's where I heard her talking to someone on the phone.
You had one simple job. Take that pampered Moggy miles away. Well, guess what? It came back.
I gasped in shock, and right then, a hand covered my mouth.
Shh. Be quiet.
Oh, but it gets worse. The stupid cat brought Leroy, the missing grandson, home. That's right. I saw that Mars birthmark with my own eyes. If Primrose finds out about this, we're done. You hear me?
Wait, so Leroy, Madame Primrose's only grandchild, is actually Hans. And his stepmom was the one who secretly gave him away in the first place. Even worse, I was hearing this shocking news with her son. Willard, get it together. Do you know anything about her plan?
I knew Mom was behind Topaz going missing. That's why I tried to take the cat away earlier, to keep him safe from her. But Leroy too? That was just heartless. What should I do now? She's my mom, after all.
I could see his pure and kind soul being tormented, and my heart ached for him. I know it must be hard, but you need to tell Madame Primrose the truth and make things right. That's a way to help your mom redeem herself, okay? He stared at me with those dreamy eyes of his, and I felt my heart turn to mush. But a phone call from Hans interrupted us. He was looking for me, saying we gotta go. Right, I had to tell him the truth. In a cab back to Hans's cottage, I told him everything, and he just burst out laughing, saying,
I'm Leroy, the heir of a millionaire. Oh, please.
I'm serious. You were brought to the foster home exactly 19 years ago, and you both have this one-of-a-kind birthmark.
Okay, so what if I'm really her grandson? I don't even know her, and I'm definitely not rich kid material.
You've been lonely your entire life. This is your chance to find the family you've always wanted. Hans was speechless. It seemed I'd hit his weak spot, and he finally agreed. We asked the driver to take us back to the mansion. But no one was awake at that hour except a gardener. He led us to a library deep into the mansion, brought out tea, and told us to wait. Just a few minutes later, Hans started coughing, and his face swelled up. Oh no, he must have been allergic to something in the tea! Panicked, I screamed for help, and the gardener came back and carried Hans to the car. But then, a hand muzzled me from behind, and everything went dark! I woke up with my head pounding and unable to move. As I tried to make sense of the situation, I realized I was tied to a chair, mouth taped, surrounded by some rusty, unsanitary medical tools. And on the other side of the room, Hans was unconscious and tied to a patient's bed. Standing next to him was Agneta and the gardener and a guy in a blouse with some kinds of tools in his hand, about to do something to Hans's birthmark. I tried to scream and struggled to break free, but I couldn't move an inch. Right at that moment, Willard barged in.
Stop this. Leave right now, or I'll call the cops for your unlicensed business. And Mom, I already know everything, so please have some remorse.
Agneta looked so ashamed of herself.
Willard, everything I did it for you. Please understand. You saw how that old hag Primrose treated me. I was so miserable. Then your dad offered to help me.
Dad? You mean Tim? How can he be my dad? Don't be such a wimp, son. I stayed and worked here like a servant just to be close to you. We did all this so you can be the only heir. You deserve that. Now, finish it.
I can't, Tim.
Get away from my mom, you dirtbag. You never cared about me. You only moved here to manipulate her to do your dirty work. A terrible person like you will never be my dad. Then I'll do it.
As he was about to lay hands on Hans, suddenly there was a meowing sound, and Topaz appeared, followed by Madame Primrose.
Step away from my grandson. You dared to live under my roof all this time and play foul tricks on my family? Take him away.
Luckily, Hans came round, and he had a tearful reunion with his grandma. They finally had the closure they deserved. Hans decided to stay in the mansion with his long-lost family. He's even planted an herbal garden there for treating and healing people, as he always wished. Madame Primrose had finally found peace, as now she had both her beloved grandson and precious cat back. She also thought that maybe she'd been too strict on Agneta, so she decided not to press any charges against her. Agneta had also apologized, but she felt too full of shame to stay and decided to move out of the mansion. Willard followed his mom and helped her start a new life. What about me? Well, I got the thing I've always dreamt of, to be Madame Primrose's apprentice. That's her gift to me for bringing both her cat and her grandson back. And, right now, I'm late for a date with a very special guy. Can you guess who it is?
Too much studying and not enough sleep was making me feel like a zombie. Chocolate would help, right? So I drowsily walked downstairs. Huh? Why was my whole family there with their suitcases? Are you guys going somewhere? Yes, Colorado for a ski trip.
That's awesome! You're the best, Daddy!
Not you, Helen. You have studying to do. And this is a special award for Christine for winning her scholarship.
What? So you're just going to leave me out because of some meaningless grades? This is so unfair.
Ugh!
Whatever. I don't even need them to go with me. Shh. Come here. And I'm gonna let you in on a secret. I can go to the ski resort by myself and have way more fun. But how, you ask? It's called lucid dreaming. I first heard about it through the biggest buzz movie, Inception, and realized that I've had experienced the same things before. Since then, I've become an expert at this. So before I go to bed, I just have to write a script saying where I want to go, with whom, what I want to do, and 3, 2, 1. I'm asleep and living my best life. In fact, I could say that those beautiful self-designed dreams are like meditation to me. Because, to be honest, my real life is tedious. No matter how hard I tried, I was no match for my younger half-sister, Christine. In my dad and grandma's eyes, a child of a doctor in physics, as well as a grandchild of a history professor, should automatically be a walking encyclopedia or something. But unfortunately, I didn't excel at the academic side of life. Ugh. They treat Christine like this precious gemstone and me like some boring old rock. Every week usually entails her getting excellent grades or winning some reward, then all of my family lavishing her with gifts and praise, while I'm treated like an outsider in my own family. Ugh! Just thinking about it makes me want to scream. So they want me to stay home and concentrate on tomorrow's test, huh? Nah, you wish. So instead, I grabbed my pen and started writing tonight's awesome dream script. Let's see. That's right. The obnoxious Roger dared to heartlessly throw the candy I gave him in the trash, even though he'd been flirting with me. What a jerk. I will definitely retaliate against him tonight. Lying in bed, I closed my eyes and repeated this sentence. I'm going to kick him out of my life. And you won't believe it. In the dream, he kept chasing me like crazy, but I totally blanked him. Helen, wake up! Time's running out! My best friend Gabby kicked my chair, and I jolted awake. Oh no, there were only 5 minutes left. I frantically ticked on the paper and hurriedly submitted it to the monitor. Hey, did you not get any sleep or something? Well, I stayed up late writing the script for my dream. It was worth it, as I got payback on Roger. What if you get a bad grade? Never mind. I'll be fine when I come home tonight with an A+ dream. But things turned out not to be as simple as I thought. That afternoon when I arrived home, I was about to sneak up to my bedroom to write my next amazing script when someone grabbed my bag strap and pulled me back. It was Grandma and Dad, and both of them seemed to be mad.
How long are you going to live like this? Education is important to this family, yet you don't seem to care. Do you realize this week alone your teacher has contacted me 3 times?
But Dad, I really don't like those boring subjects.
I only like no more drawing or writing your silly stories. You need to focus on your studies, else you'll end up a useless person like...
She suddenly stopped, which made me curious. Like who? But neither she nor my dad said anything. They just quietly walked away, leaving me alone. Honestly, I never wanted to disappoint them that much. So this time I was going to try my best to not let them down.
Dad,
Grandma, look, look, I got a B+ in my math test.
No one cared what I said. My stepmom cuddled Christine and looked at her with sparkling eyes.
My wonderful daughter, I know the top student award is just a piece of cake to you, unlike someone else.
Then she turned to me and tutted,
Helen, please, you're making a show of yourself. That's embarrassing. My face fell, and I forced back tears.
But I tried so hard to get this grade. A B+ is nothing to be proud of. I chucked my exam paper in the trash, then stormed up to my room. It didn't matter what I did or how hard I tried, this household would always treat me like a loser.
Dream on, Helen. Go back to your happy place. In front of me was the crimson sunset sky. I'd been scripting this moment for so long, lounging lazily on the beach without anyone complaining. But suddenly the sky darkened, and the inky clouds seemed intent on swallowing me.
Huh? What was going on? This wasn't a part of the script. Terrified, I ran into a forest, but it was so dark and spooky here, and I tripped over a branch and fell. Ouch! As I rubbed my ankle and started crying my eyes out, suddenly a strange woman appeared. She took me into a wooden house at the end of the forest and gently helped bandage me up. This woman, well, she didn't scare me at all. Instead, I felt warm around her. Curious, I tried to take a closer look at her face, but then I suddenly woke up and realized tears were rolling down my cheeks. What a strange dream. I immediately drew all the things I'd seen. That forest, that house, but strangely, I couldn't remember that woman's face.
Why are you drawing all this nonsense?
My dad snatched the sketch from my hand and looked at it, frowning.
It appeared in my dream and...
Get rid of them all. From now on, if I see you wasting your time on these stupid drawings again, there will be consequences.
This was too much. I couldn't live without drawing. It was the only thing keeping me sane. I had to get out of here. Live my way. Forget them and their stupid standards. I would create my own world. I planted myself in Gabby's room, and this is where I've been for almost a week. Luckily, Gabby's parents are totally chill with me staying. As for my family, they haven't messaged me once. And yes, dreams do go on. But now I dreaded going to sleep as my lucid dreams were still all messed up. Sometimes beautiful, sometimes bad. And for the most part, it did not turn out the way I wanted it to anymore. Until one day, that creepy forest appeared again. No matter how much I screamed to wake myself up, I still couldn't get out of that nightmare. Panicked, I kept running and running in the hope of finding a safe place till I saw that woman. And once again, she reached out her hand to help me. This time, I wouldn't miss my chance. I looked carefully at her face, remembering every detail, and as soon as I woke up, I drew her.
Wow, I didn't know you watched this kind of show.
Gabby giggled. What show?
Look, she's a celebrity. She hosts some TV show that my mom watches sometimes.
So, that woman is a real person? If so, I have to find her. I didn't really know what was going on, only that there was something tying me to this woman and I needed to figure this out. Luckily, Gabby has an uncle who works at the studio, and he gave us special passes to meet this host in the flesh. When the cameras stopped filming, she turned and saw me, and her eyes widened in alarm.
Helen? Helen, is it really you?
Then she rushed over and hugged me.
Huh? What did she just say? We didn't know each other, and...
The weird thing is, this hug didn't feel strange at all. Instead, I felt the same warmth as when she'd taken care of me in my dream. As she loosened her embrace on me and gave me this beaming smile, I said,
and you are?
Darling, it's me, your mother. That's when I realized something. Of course, she was my mom.
Look, we had the same eyes. Needless to say, this was a huge shock. We hugged each other for a long time in tears. Then Mom took me backstage, got me a glass of water, then she told me everything.
So after I was born, Mom once got caught up in a cheating scandal. Dad was angry about the damage this would do to his career, so he kicked her out of the house and wouldn't let her see me. A long time later, she found out that Grandma was behind everything, just because she didn't approve of this marriage, so she came up with that plan.
But why didn't you ever try to find me when you've always been living this close?
Oh, no, sweetie.
I've always kept an eye on you. One time, years ago, I saw you playing in the park. You had your hair in pigtails and... I tried to approach you, but your dad threatened me. He is a very powerful man who's actually capable of destroying my life. And I didn't think it was fair to drag you through all of that. But things have changed now. I'll never leave you alone, ever again. I strolled into the house like normal, and everyone stopped what they were doing and glared at me with disgust.
Oh, you're back.
If you're not prepared to study properly, then don't bother staying.
I took a deep breath, then said, You can't treat me like this anymore. I try my best, and it's not fair that you punish me for just being me. So I'm leaving, and I'm never coming back.
Psst, where will you go?
That's when Mom walked in. Oh God, you should have seen the looks on their faces. Grandma actually looked like she'd swallowed a swarm of wasps.
I stood by and let you manipulate and control me. Well, no more. I'm taking my daughter, and we're going to have the life we both deserve.
Then, ignoring their angry words, she grabbed my arm and led me out of there. So that's the moment when I left home and moved in with my mom. Now I draw as much as I want. In fact, Mom's letting me create a mural on the living room wall. It's going to be epic when it's finished. Oh, and about the lucid dreams, I don't write scripts anymore. Instead, I realize that I'm better off focusing on my reality and making myself the best version of myself I can be. After all, as great as a dream world can be, it's nowhere near as good as experiencing life firsthand.
Hey there, I'm Evie from Georgia. So, I look like a regular teenage girl, right? Just you wait till you see what I can do. Kids these days are so rude and unruly. I blame the parents. There's just no discipline anymore. See, they don't even respect their principal. But no big deal. I know just how to handle them. There we go. Just a few words and the class immediately went silent. What is this, Mrs. Gardner? That trip was all we've been looking forward to for months. Thanks to everyone's disruptive behavior. Well, to be exact, thanks to the actions of you, 25 out of 300 students, no one has anything to look forward to this year. Okay, then go on, ma'am. Punish us. But why drag the whole year group into this? Other classes will definitely not leave us alone after this. Nobody likes being punished. That's why it works. Now, let's see what your peers make of this, shall we? The whole class was buzzing with, so unfair, abuse of power, wicked witch. Oh my, these kids, always full of energy. Go back to your seats and write an apology letter to Miss Helen, along with a promise to never misbehave again, or else. All of them reluctantly sat down. And there we have it. Oh my God. Who are you? It's just that these unruly students need to learn a lesson for getting Mrs. Helen so exhausted that she ended up in the hospital. And so you just decided to mimic me. Well then, please inform your mom. We will have a talk about this. Here, tomorrow morning. I glumly walked home as slowly as possible. As soon as I walked through the door, Mom was glaring at me. Yup, my mom is Miss Helen, the kindest homeroom teacher ever. However, the kids in her class made her life a misery, which led Mom to get high blood pressure and end up in the hospital. I just wanted to help her, but instead, I just managed to make things worse. Hi, Mom. I'm sorry, but I don't regret what I did. Mom started lecturing me about how it was bad enough that Dad had left and her students were rebellious without me acting like a crazy person. Crazy person? She means the times when I copy the people I want to be? But that's my hobby. I inherited that passion from my father, a famous special effect makeup artist. The feeling whenever I successfully transform into someone else is awesome. And it also helps me feel connected to my dad, even though I haven't seen him in a long time.
It all started when I was 13, and Dad helped me dress up as my fave idol for the school festival. Dad taught me how to analyze the character and practice the disguise. Bold eyeliner, smoky eyes, contouring, plus the bodycon outfits. I looked like a real CL from 2NE1. My friends loved my new look. So over the next few years, I masqueraded into many different people, including Lady Gaga, Avril Lavigne, Miley Cyrus, and Sia. The feeling that my makeup talent was that admired and anticipated was just really addictive. Hey, is it Billie Eilish this time? Why not Taylor Swift? I love her so much. I've always done whatever I want and always been exactly who I am. Wow, you got that spot on. Are you a shapeshifter or something? Needless to say, once I imitated someone, I made sure I got their gestures and mannerisms just right. My talent didn't stop at awesome makeup. I was trying to collect things from my locker when a stampede of students raced past me and almost knocked me off my feet. Huh? Who was that strange and rather handsome guy they were chasing? Look at him swaggering. Does he think he's Donald Trump or something? That's Xander. He just transferred here. Keep your voice down, by the way. You don't want to annoy his fan base. Poof! I'm not afraid of those way too girly girls who go crazy for boys. Huh, no one scares you, do they, Evie? Now let's go have some granola. Leo may like boring granola, but no thanks. I'm having a hamburger and fried chicken. Billie Eilish is not the type to turn down delicious food for health freak nonsense. Oh, there's that obnoxious Xander again. But this time he's all over Kayla, the snooty hot girl from my class. A boy approached me asking to take a selfie with me, then suddenly I heard a scream. What do you think you're doing? I turned to see what was going on and saw Kayla going ballistic at some poor girl who'd accidentally tripped over and fallen into Xander's lap. What on earth do you think you're doing? Take a look at yourself before trying to attract my man. Ugly doofus. How snobby. Did she think her beauty was that splendid to help her keep her man? But not with that empty head, girl. After a few days of research, I showed up at school looking just like Kayla. I'd perfected everything, from her blonde hair, makeup, clothes, walk, and voice. Honestly, this time I was quite nervous. Dressing up as someone I actually knew was always extra scary, especially when her friends were walking over. Wow, that dress is so chic. You really are the fashionista of our school, Kay. Come on, Xander's waiting for us on the sports field. Please, do you think I really want you around? I'm just taking advantage of you. And you keep following me around like a pet. It's so tragic. Are you crazy? I know you like Xander too. I see the gooey looks you give him. When I'm done with him, I'll consider giving him to you. I walked away leaving the girls freaking out. But I didn't say anything different from what Kayla thought, though, right? If only she would be so frank with her friends. Now let's get to the main target. Thinking about him gave me goosebumps. I'm busy, bae. Go hang with your friends for now. He was playing Call of Duty on his phone. I was here to break up with him, but hang on a minute. This guy had skill. I want to have a go. Since when did you know how to play this game? He looked kind of touched that I was showing an interest. Okay, I'll wait until after this, and then we will split up. I looked for Leo, but he didn't even recognize me. Poor him. He'd been searching for Billie Eilish since morning. While Leo was complaining, he helped me quickly remove my makeup so I could go back to looking like me before anyone guessed what I'd just done. From that day onwards, Kayla's friends cut her off, so she could only cling to Xander. And from my point of view, he seemed to be tired of this clingy girl. Now even her look made him sick, huh? The time has come. I put makeup on as Kayla again and found him. I want this bag. Don't try to trick me with a fake one.
Okay, as you wish.
I want you to give up COD. That way you can only stay by my side.
Okay, I'll follow you all day.
I want to throw a party and invite the whole school.
Your task is to get everyone to gather around me like they used to. If you can't do that, we'll break up.
Deal. But I see everyone likes you. Right, Evie?
Holy mother! Did he recognize me already? But since when?
I have to acknowledge your talent. If only you hadn't shown me your charm, you wouldn't have been exposed. Well, Kayla looks like a picture, but a dull one compared to you. You have such a good eye. However, you're no different from her. Miss Helen is your mom, right? Don't be surprised. I'm a better observer than you think. Just like you. I know that Kayla was the instigator of the disturbance in the class that sent your mom to the hospital. I already apologized to your mom for Kayla's behavior. And if you want to know why I did that, it's because I have a big crush on you. Oh my god. I didn't expect things to turn out this way. But, okay. Taking it as a slap in the face for Kayla on behalf of my mom, I still agreed to date him. The next day, I showed up again at school as Ariana Grande, simply because I wanted to. But this time, I also played another role, Xander's girlfriend. As usual, every time I dressed up as a new character, all eyes were on me. But this time, it was more epic when I walked side by side with the hottest guy in school. When Leo saw that I was with Xander, he rolled his eyes at me, then walked off. Then Kayla walked around the corner, saw us together, and started shouting at me. How dare you steal my man? You're just some pathetic wannabe! Xander took my arm and yelled at her. Evie's creative, sweet, and really funny. I want to be with her. I like her. Kayla's face dropped. Then she pointed her finger in front of him. How could you do this to me? I will get you back for this. Then she huffed off. Xander looked at me and asked if I was okay. Then he invited everyone to a party at his house that night to celebrate the fact that I was now his girlfriend. Was he serious? But whatever. It would be rude to say no, right? So that evening, I went to his party. To my surprise, Kayla was already there, so I flirted with Xander to annoy her further. Then suddenly, Xander leaned in close to my face, which made my whole body feel hot. What was happening? He was going to kiss me? But then he whispered in my ear, "You haven't told me how you feel about me yet."
You were looking forward to this answer, weren't you? But before I could reply, Leo appeared out of nowhere, grabbed my hand, and dragged me out of there. Ugh! What on earth are you doing?
I'm the one who should be asking you that question. What on earth were you going to say? That I have feelings for you too? This whole thing is a setup between Xander and Kayla to humiliate you. Lucky for you, I arrived just in time to overhear Kayla talking to her friends about this dirty plan.
Are you done talking? Do you really think I'd fall into their trap that easily? I already know their dirty tricks, and I was about to tell everyone what jerks they are. But then you showed up and ruined my plan.
I don't care how clever and perfect your plan is. How long are you going to continue this tiring game of dispute?
They think just because they're both hot that they can treat everyone else like they're puppets. Well, I've had enough.
Evie, you're better than this. I don't like this revenge-seeking version of you. Can you please just stop it and go back to normal?
Leo walked away in a huff and left me out here alone in the street. I stormed home and took off my makeup. Why was Leo so mad at me? I did nothing wrong. The gentle Leo I knew never had gotten mad or even went against my will, and was always the most enthusiastic supporter every time I imitated someone. What had gotten into him? I called him continuously, but Leo turned off the phone. Ugh. I felt so alone, it was horrible. Then I heard a knock on my door. Mom peered her head around it. Seeing me upset, she came over and cuddled me. It felt good having her comfort me, so I ended up blurting out everything to her. It sounds like Leo was just worried about you. But as for Xander and Kayla, they're not worth your time or effort. Don't become someone you're not just to get revenge on people who don't deserve you. But suddenly,
I heard rustling outside of my bedroom window. Then Leo poked his head through it.
If you're not tired, then keep copying.
You keep following me around like a pet. Go live your own real life. Mom and I both laughed along with him. Then I hugged Leo and told him I was sorry. It's true that pretending to be someone else is exhausting, and I must admit I was wrong to use Kayla's name to sabotage her relationships. Tomorrow, I'll find her and apologize, even though I don't want to, but I have to find a way to end this peacefully. Then, I can focus on just being me for a while, without any of the drama.